Good afternoon, and welcome to the November 10th, 2016, special meeting of the Plaquemines Port Harbor and Terminal District. I'd like to call the meeting to order at 1:05 p.m. Take a roll call, please. Let the record reflect that all nine council members are present. And that the executive director and his staff are present as well. If you would now please stand for the prayer by Director Rick Freeman, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance.
Let us bow our heads. Father God, we thank you for this time that we take to honor you, Lord God. We ask you to be in every decision that is being made here today, Lord God. And Lord, we impress upon you, Lord God, the hearts of those that have been elected to lead our country, Lord. We ask that you guide and direct them and strengthen them, Lord, and change mindsets that they have themselves and put your mind upon them. Father, we ask that you protect our country as well as our parish. We ask that you look out for us, Lord God. And in our upcoming parish election, Lord God, we ask that you be in the midst of that, Lord. We ask that you bless the people that are in control. And we ask that you bring the provision forward, Lord God. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, thank you. We have no executive session, so item two is done. We'll move to status report by the Executive Port Director, General.
Good afternoon, Mr. President, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Vice Chairman, members of the board, and fellow citizens. I am Sandy Sanders, Executive Director of Plaquemines Port Harbor and Terminal District. What follows is my Executive Director's report for the reporting period of 27 October to 10 November of 2016. We continue to work with the port's option holder to provide the needed river frontage for their requirements. We're making very good headway with this, and we should have it finished with a bow on it by the end of December. I attended the Inland Marine and Intermodal Conference in Memphis during this reporting period and had tremendous success in advancing our strategic vision. During this time, we coordinated joint meetings with American Patriot Holdings, speaking with Mr. Scott Siegman, who's the executive director of the Illinois Soy Council, regarding their future export soy requirements utilizing the APH new design. We plan to meet again in December, and we also plan to do a joint proof of principle soon. Also met with the officers of CenterPoint Properties regarding the potential use of their services in developing and managing logistically advantaged real estate. We met initially at the Rail Summit in Chicago last year, and we had also planned to meet again, as we just did in Memphis. We also will continue these talks in December. These folks are the premier folks into developing warehousing and distribution centers off-site of the Maritime Port campus, and also the properties that could be developed in the vicinity of the Naval Air Station Joint Reserve Base in conjunction with the introduction of the commercial air cargo at the Navy base. And once again, this fits perfectly with the port's strategic vision and action plan. We are coordinating also with a follow-up visit to the Maritime Administration, MARAD, in December, in the December timeframe, on a joint basis with American Patriot Holdings and PPHD. We have seen where other ports have received federal grants surrounding the Maritime Highway Program, and this has been created by this container on vessel opportunity. APH has a premier design, and I've already spoken to the folks at MARAD, and they are waiting to see it. We have coordinated with HILA personnel for ongoing training for our fire suppression systems on our board. Donald Durr has also integrated all of our maritime folks, vessel personnel, into this training. I have met with and initiated contact with the Memphis Chamber of Commerce Economic Development Council regarding a site for both consolidation and deconsolidation of containers utilizing the APH container on barge concept. The sites we visited were in the heart of the Mississippi River region next to the CN-CSX intermodal yard that brings all transportation modes to a certain geographic point. This is consistent with our strategic vision as a transportation hub at the southern terminus of the Mississippi River, arranging scheduled services to the three most important inland distribution points along the Mississippi River, that being Memphis, St. Louis, and Chicago. At the end of our presentation today, at the end of our board meeting, we will receive a briefing today from Mr. Lee Alexander with Daybrook Fisheries to highlight their firm's operation. We have coordinated a similar highlight to appear in the Plaquemines Gazette, as was done with the CHS elevator. And lastly, if y'all notice, if you came across the ferry up by Belle Chasse, you may have seen the first vessel, the name Trinity Borg, that came to the CCI property. I've spoken with the folks at CCI, and once again, they thank me, and for me to thank the board for what y'all did as far as them getting that FTZ piggyback with the Port of South Louisiana. Mr. Chairman, subject to your questions and any questions from the board or the audience, this concludes my brief.
I appreciate that. Before I open up to the table or to the audience, I'd like to bring up Mr. Eric Sundstrom. Welcome, Eric.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, members of the commission. Eric Sundstrom, representing the Plaquemines Port Harbor and Terminal District. Wanted to brief you all on Monday, October 31st, we hosted, well, Representative Leopold hosted Councilman Black, a couple representatives from the DOTD, the chairman of the House Transportation Committee, Senate Transportation Committee, and representatives from the Plaquemines Parish Government and Jefferson Parish Government on a flyover of some transportation needs. We toured the Belle Chasse Tunnel, flew down along the river, along Highway 23, looking at the levees, the highway, where it's being widened, where the money needs to go. We are also coordinating through Mr. Sanders' office to do a similar port tour on December 7th with those same folks, with the legislative delegation along Jefferson Parish and Plaquemines Parish, and also Secretary Wilson. So we are working on that, and hopefully we'll have more to report for the December meeting. And that concludes my report, if there's any questions.
Yeah, I appreciate it, Eric, and I really appreciate you helping Representative Leopold set that tour up. I think it was very beneficial. Like I mentioned at the port committee meeting, a lot of key players were involved in that tour. And ironically enough, when we did tour the tunnel, as you know, we caught the bridge, so we had to go through it through the southbound side. So it was definitely very timely. But I appreciate it. I'll open it up now to the table and to the audience if there's any questions or comments for the director or Mr. Sundstrom. All right, nothing from the table or the audience. All right, Mr. Sundstrom, I appreciate it. General Sanders, thank you so much. We will now move to bids and advertisements. Item 4, we have none. We will go on to item 5, introduction of ordinances and resolutions. Mr. Bartholomew?
None.
I have a few, so bear with me. A lot of housekeeping items. A resolution electing the Plaquemines Port Harbor and Terminal District Chairperson for 2017 and otherwise brought respect thereto. A resolution electing the Plaquemines Port Harbor and Terminal District Vice Chairperson for 2017 and otherwise provided with respect thereto. A resolution appointing the members of the Port Committee of the Plaquemines Parish Council for 2017 and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. A resolution to provide insurance for the Plaquemines Port Harbor and Terminal District for a period of January 1, 2017 through December 31st, 2017 and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. A resolution to provide port employees group coverages consisting of health, dental, vision, and life for the policy period of January 1st, 2017 through December 31st, 2017, on an employer-employee contributing basis of 83% to 17%, and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. An ordinance to amend and as amended readopt ordinance number 16-91 dated August 25th, 2016, which authorized the appropriation of funds from the Portland Purchase Fund to be used for the removal in inadequately sized culverts and installation of appropriately sized culverts as determined necessary with the assistance and guidance of Plattman's Parish Engineering Department in ditches and canals located on port property and adjacent property where port property drainage is impacted and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. An ordinance adopting the original operating budget of revenues and expenditures of the Plattman's Port Harbor and Terminal District for the fiscal year beginning January 1st, 2017 and ending December 31st, 2017 and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. An ordinance establishing a policy of budgetary control for the operating budget of expenditures for the Plattman's Port Harbor and Terminal District for the fiscal year beginning January 1st, 2017 and ending December 31st, 2017 and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. An ordinance adopting the original capital improvement budget for the Plattman's Port Harbor and Terminal District for the five-year period beginning January 1st, 2017 and ending December 31st, 2021 and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. That's all I have, Mr. Juneau.
I have no.
Mr. Russo, Mr. Lapine, Mr. Burt, Ms. Solvent, Ms. Edgecombe,
I have none,
Ms. Williams. All right. Let's move to item 6A. We have none. 6B, Ms. Marcotte.
The resolution authorizing the executive director of the Plaquemines Port Harbor and Terminal District to accept and execute an agreement for the providing of independent financial auditing services for the Plaquemines Port Harbor and Terminal District for a period of January 1st, 2017 through December 31st, 2017 with the option to renew for an additional year and otherwise provide with respect thereto.
I'll offer. Second by Mr. Lapine. We will open this to the table for any questions, concerns. If we have none, we'll move to the audience. Anybody, questions, comments? All right, with none, we will move to vote. Ms. Sullivan. The record reflect the resolution passes 8-1. With a no vote from District 5. All right, new business. We have no introductions or resolution where suspension is being sought. We will now move to item 7B, a presentation by Daybook Fisheries. General Sanders, you want to do the introductions?
I'd like to introduce the folks here to Mr. Alexander. He's the managing director at Daybook Fisheries. And this is in concert with our new series of highlighting a business here along our river, which is our most important asset that we have here in the parish. I can say that Mr. Alexander has been a stalwart with us in our efforts to get Baptiste Collette dredge. This would greatly help out the fisheries as far as being a avenue to the Eastern Gulf, but it also is a huge safety factor for his boats. He was also very instrumental in helping us when we got the emergency funding when the Baptiste Collette was shoaled in and the closure of the docks came at the same time. He's been a real friend to the port, a real friend to the parish, and may introduce to y'all Lee Alexander. Thank you.
Thank you for having me, and thank you, Chairman and Mr. President. And what I'll do is I just want to give a little synopsis of Daybook Fisheries, what we do, and how we interface with Plaquemines, and also if employment and any questions at the end. So go ahead next. Daybook, we fly our flag proudly in Plaquemines Parish. That was the only facility of Daybook. Next. That's the entranceway. Go ahead. Now, as far as the United States is concerned, we're centrally located, and if you can see, go ahead and to the next slide. We are able to fish on the left and or the east and the west of Plaquemines Parish, which gives us the advantage of any fisheries in the United States. As you may know, left, next, with our protected harbor that we have outside of Adams Bay, next, We have got our facility. The Mississippi River is only 600 feet away from the plant. We sit on a canal in the navigational canal. And go next. By the way, a lot of people have asked what we do. And I was just met the gentleman down in Port Sulphur, and he says, I've never heard of Daybrook. And it sort of surprised me. So I said, where the blue buildings on the left-hand side of the bridge as you're coming over from Empire? He says, oh, you mean the Pogey plant. And he said, what do you catch? And we said, menhaden. He says, what is that? So that is a menhaden fish, formerly known as a Pogey. Next. This is West Bank fishing. Recently, we have been purchased by a South African company. So Daybrook will stay the same on the land side. The 11 vessels and 11 of airplanes will go to the West Bank side. As far as the personnel and the management, it will remain the same. Now, about the fleet, as I said before, we have 11 refrigerated purse-seine vessels. There are about 180 feet long each. They all have refrigeration systems. They have a carrying capacity of approximately 500 tons of raw fish. Vessel specification, as I said before, 38 feet wide, 180 feet long, with two small 40-foot purse boats on the back. Apparently, the picture didn't come through. We have 11 captains. I'm not sure why the photographs are that way. And also, we have airplanes. The aircraft pilots are supposed to have been shown next. And we also have 12 182S Cessnas in our aircraft for spotting the fish. Next. Now, with the blended leaderboard, this is all of the menhaden fishing in the Gulf of Mexico. That includes Omega Protein, which is, they just recently closed their plant in Cameron. They also have one in Moss Point, Mississippi, and one in Abbeville, Louisiana. As you can see, our captains constitute basically the top half of all the captains. Go ahead. Now, this is sort of interesting. Sanders was talking about ports. Not many people know about it, but this is the ranking, and I'm not showing the top 500, just the top 32. Number one is Dutch Harbor, Alaska. Number two is Empire, Louisiana. We land more fish in Empire as far as tonnage than any other place in the United States except for Dutch Harbor. We have marine operations where we repair, maintain, with ship repairs actually on the site itself. Go ahead. And we have our own machine shop, welding and fabrication, engines, refrigeration systems, electrical. And one of the things I want to highlight here is that we have employees that are in Plaquemines Parish. We have approximately, during the fishing season, about 360 employees. Without the fishing season, 165, of which about 200 live in Plaquemines Parish with their families and with housing. And all of those titles that you see, we do need employees of highly skilled, and they're highly paid. And we do need more, and I'll get back to that later. Next. One of the items that we do, just a midship project, we'll remove the entire midship of a particular vessel on site. Go ahead. We prepared it by removing all the pieces and parts on the ship to make it less technical, but we actually removed the whole center section. We removed all the insulation on the inside. We replaced it with a new bottom that we actually engineered and fabricated on site. That's the inside of the new pump house and engine room after the work was completed, and that's the finished product. You can't even tell the difference. So as far as anything should happen, we can replace a main engine on our vessels within 6 hours. So we have the men, the crews there that can work 24 hours a day, 7 days a week during the fishing season, which is from the third week in April to November 1st. As hopefully a lot of people know, we have a thing called the Blessing of the Fleet in the third Sunday in April. We had approximately 550 people out there last year. That included everyone in Plaquemines was invited, We served 2,800 pounds of crawfish. And we also had face painting for the kids and refrigerated bathrooms, which were nice during that time. The fishing, we have a fishing area, as I said before, we can fish east or west, depending on which way the wind's blowing. And that's the advantage we have for anywhere else in the Gulf. We can fish on both sides of the river. We also have, we bail the fish on board and we unload at the factory. Next. That's one of our planes with our two purse boats with a 1,500-foot net that's extended around the fish, and one of our spotter pilots flying over the set. We only fish in 8 to 15 feet of water, so the nets do not have bottoms to it. So we set the nets, and the menhaden fish are remarkable. They swim upwards when they're netted, not downwards. The other fish go out. Now, the thing that a lot of people ask for is sustainability in the Gulf. Presently, we have, during the fishing season, a representative from NOAA, the National Oceanographic Association, to check what we catch every single day. So at the last time official document came out from Beaufort, North Carolina, we had caught 0.0004%. Bycatch, not 1%, 1/4 ten-thousandths of a percent. And they counted 4 redfish in 3 million menhaden. So we have a very good track record of really catching only the menhaden, no bycatch. This is one of we're actually hauling the fish in at this particular time. We also have our own nets. We have the nets that are bought from Mississippi, India, and Peru. We bring them in and we assemble them ourselves in our net shed repair room. In our net shed, we hire 25 individuals that are working 7 days a week during the fishing season. We have a building that's 800 feet long. It has 4 monorail systems. And it's a concrete floor structure that we were able to repair net. So if you come in with a broken net, we reel it off. We replace a new net that we have. Every boat has 3 nets, and you can leave within 1 hour. Go ahead. I won't go into all the details, but basically we're a vertically systematic, where we have the boats coming in on the left. They're slightly cooked, then they're pressed. The solids go into dryers, and after they're dried properly and ground, that becomes our fish meal. We made approximately 65,000 tons of fish meal last year, which is sold to Iams, Purina, Blue Buffalo, and other dog and food and ingredients for cat food, and also for the salmon fishing industry. On the other side, after you press it, the water and oil goes out, and we made approximately 30,000 tons of fish oil, which goes into pills, fish oil, and also to salmon farming in 17 different countries. Their only byproduct after we do that is water vapor. Next. That's the aerial view of the facility. And then one thing we did after Katrina, we used to have just dirt and gravel on our parking lots, our parking areas. We have now concrete everywhere. We actually concrete paved the entire site, over 12 and a half acres of concrete. That not only cuts down salmonella, it cuts down the dust in the neighborhood, and it also will get to, go ahead, and also gets cuts down on the pollution, and I'll get to that in a little bit. We put approximately 6 million fish of raw fish into bins, so that's what an empty stainless steel bin looks like. Next. That's what a full one looks like. So we catch approximately, last year we caught 686 million fish. Sounds like a lot of fish. It is. However, right now, according to the federal government, we're at 4% to 5% of sustainability. Because of the fisheries that are consolidated, only 3 on the Gulf Coast, we have we're looking to expand, but we have a 95 to 96% increase if we were to do that. And what I mean by that is we'd have to catch something like 20 times more fish before we'd hurt the sustainability. Okay? We slightly cook them, as I said before. Go ahead. And one of the things I wanted to show in the last, there's no people on the plant when we're running it. It's all run by computers, and it's all automated. What the majority of our people do is in maintenance and repair. Go ahead. We have a dryer. These dryers that we dry the fish out, and they're able to dry up to 20 tons or 60 tons an hour. They're 72 feet long, 15 feet wide, so they're quite substantial. But we're also trying to save energy. We're 100% natural gas. We do not use any diesel. Go ahead. We also have the control panels, and we hire highly skilled technicians to do this. And that's one of the things I want to emphasize at the end as far as employment goes. We also have three boilers. Because of our the way we've been being more efficient in our plant, we only use two boilers rather than three like we used to since before Katrina, and one is always a spare. We also test our product seven times when the raw fish come in. We actually test the raw fish to the end product. And then one of the things I want to notice is a lot of people prior to Katrina would always know when they're driving down the plant on Highway 23. Everyone told me how much it smelled. On the right-hand side, you can sort of see a lot of silver pipes and vessels. That's a scrubber system. We built that for about $1.5 million. It did not improve efficiency. It did not improve the product quality. What it did was it eliminated all vapor and all smells. So when you're driving down Highway 23, you don't smell it anymore. That was put in as a goodwill gesture for the for Plaquemines Parish and for our own employees that live around us. There's some of the meal that we have. Go ahead. We ship, as I said before, to almost two dozen countries. We ship it in one-ton bags and in bulk. Again, we have further testing. We're one of the only labs in the country that test the product from beginning to end in seven different ways. So when we say what we're going to make at the beginning, we can make it within 1% of our specifications. When you go to Europe, Norway, Denmark, or Peru or Chile, they only test it after they're done, so they don't even know what they've made until they're done. We store 20,000 tons of fish oil. Go ahead. And as everyone knows about Katrina, there were two of our boats were on the Empire Bridge after Katrina. Go ahead. That's Empire after Katrina. Next. And that's also the Woodland Plantation. And then here's the reason I go to the next one. Stay here for a second. What we'd like to do is appreciate what Plaquemines Parish has done for us. And we've shown this around the nation. Highway 23 has been raised because of everybody knows during Gustav, Isaac, and, well, of course, Katrina, no one could get down to the lower Plaquemines Parish without taking a route around the Phillips 66. Now you can drive down there in case of high water. All the power lines are installed or hurricane-proof from Belle Chasse to Port Sulphur. They completed the new river levee, heightening up to 18 feet. Increased the Port Sulphur above the flood stage. A new floodgate on Adams Bay and a new floodgate on the Mississippi River at Empire is being installed as we speak. That is going to really help out tremendously. And also, as we're presently dredging the marshlands with dredge silt to the river to create land that disappeared. That'll also help with the storm surge. So that, we really are appreciated to Plaquemines Parish. Not only did we help the people in the lower Plaquemines, but you also helped us with our employment of 300-plus people. There's the power poles, as I said before. There's the locks being constructed. The floodgate on Adams Bay. And I want to emphasize our people. We, as I said before, employ over 300 individuals. This is a safety banquet. that we have in late March or February of every single year. That is for their employees and their spouses and or girlfriends. It's we like to say that they walk in, they get gifts. We have safety presentations that are fun, and a lot of people really look forward to this. This is their big highlight of the year, is the big safety banquet. It is at the Burris Auditorium. We've held it at the YMCA in Port Sulphur, but we like the venue here. One thing is the size of the venue. It's rather large, and we really retain our people. Go to the next. One of the things that I want to emphasize with the safety is we've received plaques from the Louisiana Workman's Comp Corporation every single year for being one of the top 70 of 18,000 employees in the state of Louisiana for safety. Next. Just to show you one of the things, we also receive refunds every single year that we maintain our safety. As you can see, in 2013, we received a refund of $112,000 from the state because of our safety record, a total of almost $500,000 coming back to us in premiums to maintain a safe product. Go ahead. The other thing is how we maintain our personnel. We give out service awards every 5 years. On the left are 5-year awards, 10, 15, 20. Go to the next. As you can see, there's 15, 25, and 30-year awards. Our employees stay with us. We try to remain loyal to our individuals. We also feed all of our employees 3 days a week, I mean 3 times a day, 7 days a week, free food if you're employed by us. That also includes the people that are living on our site. Go ahead. And that concludes the formal presentation of the fish meal and fish oil. That's our final product. I do want to emphasize that we are currently looking for welders. We're currently looking for purchase order managers. And I'm not talking about takers or clerks. I'm talking about actual managers and also mechanical engineers and maintenance personnel on the management or in the leadership ability. So that concludes it. If there's any questions.
I just want to say I appreciate the presentation and taking time out of your day to come and provide this to the council. It's much appreciated, and I'm sure I speak on behalf of the entire council that we all appreciate all the jobs that you provide to our residents here at Plaquemines Parish. So thank you, and we look forward to helping you out in any way that we can. I'll open it up to the table now.
I just want to say thank you, Mr. Lee, and thank you, Daybrook, for being in our parish.
Thank you.
Unbelievable job.
I appreciate it.
I want to thank you as well, and I would like you to elaborate. I don't know if you are affiliated with this, but Daybrook does offer scholarships. I don't know if that's through y'all or another part of the organization.
No, that's us.
Okay. You know, they do give back to the community as far as, you know, with the schools and the scholarships. They award scholarships. For the last couple of years, they've been doing the program, and it helps out. And it's open to everyone, but mostly they look at Plaquemines residents first. So that takes priority, and I appreciate that. That's, you know, thank y'all for doing business with us.
That's with the Daybrook Foundation, and we do have been awarding scholarships to Plaquemines residents. And also, there's a little-known fact, and we should get it out more. We're also sponsors with PABI. We serve on the board. We're also, as you probably know, Borden Wallace was the former king of the Orange Festival recently, 2-3 years ago. And there's one other little fact that I would like to make it on the record, is that everybody that lives in Plaquemines Parish, I don't care if you work for Daybrook or not, is entitled to a free life insurance policy through Daybrook. And all you have to do is sign up as long as you live, prove that you live in our parish. So that's open to everybody, not Daybrook employees.
I appreciate it. Mr. Lapine?
Thank you for everything Daybrook does for Plaquemines Parish. Question, how many employees do you have?
During the season, 355, 360. During the off-season, 165.
But that was my next question. When the off-season, is that what they're doing? Is cleaning boats or maintenance or?
That's correct. Basically, during the off-season, we tear down the boats. As I said before, we actually tear down one of the boats and replace the entire midsection. On the plant side, we actually tear down every single piece of equipment, cookers, presses, dryers, the whole nine yards, down to its parts and pieces, clean it and reassemble it. And we also have capital improvement projects. We've been averaging about $8 million a year in capital improvements. This year, our budget's around $5.5 million of capital improvements.
Now, of that 350, would you know the percentage of Plaquemines Parish residents?
Yes. We have approximately 180 Plaquemines Parish employees. Most of the people that do not live in Plaquemines Parish are the actual fishermen and some of the captains. So that's during the on season. But during the off season, 100% of our employees all live in Plaquemines Parish.
All right. Thank you.
Anyone else from the table? We'll open up to the audience. Any questions or comments from the audience?
Okay.
All right. With that, I appreciate your time. Once again, thank you for everything you do.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, Ms. Marcotte, item 8.
Approval of the October 27, 2016 meeting minutes.
I'll offer. Ms. Williams, second.
Second.
You ready? Minutes are approved, 9-0. Look for a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Mr. Edgecombe, Mr. Lapine, seconds. Motion passes 9-0. We have an adjournment at 1:40 p.m. Thank you.
Well, oh, 3 minutes.
We're going to take about 3 minutes before we start the council meeting.
Call the council meeting to order. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We'll call the council meeting of November 10th, 2016 to order at 1:49. The machine is open for roll call. Let the record reflect there are non-sitting council members. Before we get started, I'd like to move to my colleagues to see for deferrals and withdrawals. Mr. Bartholomew?
Have none.
Thank you. Mr. Black?
1 second.
Okay.
Yeah, let's defer 6A1.
Verse
6A1. I'm going to hold open all for now. That may be deferred as well, but
okay.
We'll see if we can get business taken care of.
Mr. Juneau?
I have
none. Thank you. Mr. Russo?
None.
Thank you. Item under myself, items H through M are deferred. H through M. Mr. Burt?
Yes, I have a few. 6A2 will be withdrawn.
6A2.
6N will be deferred. 6O will be deferred.
Okay.
And 7G will be deferred.
7G, okay. Thank you. Ms. True, Ms. Alvant?
I have none.
Thank you. Mr. Edgecombe?
Let's defer 6Q, please.
6Q.
7.
Okay. Ms. Williams?
I don't have any, sir.
Okay. Quick recap.
What are you doing?
6A1 is deferred. 6A2 is withdrawn. 6H through O are deferred. And 6Q is deferred. And 7G is deferred. Before we move to executive session, Ms. Barber, will you read the item 5 proclamations, please.
Sorry.
A proclamation declaring November 17, 2016 as South Plaquemines High School Day. Councilmember Williams.
Is she going to read it? Ms. Williams?
Yeah.
I need a second.
I'll offer and I will ask for a unanimous second.
A unanimous second? Yes, ma'am. Okay, can you read the proclamation?
I'll read it, yeah. Mm-hmm. You want to read it, Barb? Or?
I'll read it.
Okay, thank you.
A proclamation proclaiming November 17, 2016 as South Plaquemines High School Day in the parish of Plaquemines. Whereas after Hurricane Katrina, the schools in the south end of the parish suffered complete devastation and faced numerous academic challenges during the rebuilding process. And whereas three schools merged together to form South Plaquemines High School. And whereas in the school's 10-year history, under the leadership of Mr. John A. Bartholomew, a team of hardworking administrators and teachers, resilient students, and supportive parents, South Plaquemines High School has progressed from a school letter of grade D to a school letter of grade A. And whereas this marks the first time in the 10-year history of the school that South Plaquemines High School has been awarded the highest letter grade rating awarded to schools throughout the state of Louisiana. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed by the Plaquemines Parish Council, represented by its duly authorized chairman, Kirk M. Lapine, and by concurrence of the parish president, Ed Terrio, representing the Plaquemines Parish Government, that it hereby declares November 17, 2016, as South Plaquemines High School Day in the parish of Plaquemines.
Thank you, Ms. Williams. Ms. Marcotte, Ms. Williams?
Yes, I just would like to congratulate Mr. Bartholomew and his team on hard work and dedication leading up to this. I know it's been a long time coming. When my daughter started out in seventh grade there, the school was a D. And now she's gone on to college and she's doing well, receiving an education from South Plaquemines High School. And I am proud to say that my son, as a freshman, is going to a school that has maintained a school letter grade of an A. So it is with great pleasure that I would present this proclamation to Mr. John Bartholomew of South Plaquemines High School.
Mr. Bartholomew, can we get a few words from you?
Thank you. Thank you, Councilman. Ms. Williams, we appreciate the support from all of our councilmen and women, because obviously this would not be possible unless we have the support from the community, the school systems, and all the families that we have. So I just have a short blurb, if you don't mind, Mr. Board President. During 2005, Hurricane Katrina made landfall in our parish, devastating our communities and our schools on the east bank and the southern end of the parish. Born through trials and tribulations, three schools became one, building on a strong foundation for years to come. That's the first stanza in our school's alma mater. During the fall of 2006, South Plaquemines High School was established. Our school served as a beacon of hope and security for our children. We provided a sense of normalcy for everyone as our community's unwavering commitment to rebuilding began to overcome adversity. Our students and our faculty members are resilient. We overcame the aftermath of Katrina, modular buildings that will leak from time to time, flooding in the classrooms when it would rain, eating cold sandwiches for breakfast and lunch. We overcame high teacher turnover, high dropout rates, disbelief, and the psychological wounds of hardships and oppression. Today's South Plaquemines High School has a rich heritage of a rich academic culture, rooted in the foundations of uplifting each other and service to mankind, while focusing on college and career certifications and opportunities for all students. We have the highest graduation rates in school history. We have the highest graduation cohort points in school history. We have the highest test scores in school history. The above achievements validates great teachers, students, and administrators. Also, it confirms that the reason why South Plaquemines High School is projected to be an A school. On November 17, 2016, the State Department will release our official school performance scores. On that day, we are inviting everyone to attend our school-wide celebration. We are celebrating 10 years of excellence and making history for South Plaquemines High School by achieving high standards. Our purpose has been fulfilled. On behalf of South Plaquemines High School, I accept today's proclamation. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bartholomew. Open it up to Mr. Bartholomew.
Yes. My name is John Bartholomew. I am. All right. But I think we need all of you to take a picture, because we always do that as protocol.
That's
as a council member, so they can put that in the archives. And things to come, they can identify the accomplishment. And I am very proud and honored. He is my son. And also, he is a principal, which I was. So the commitment is there within him. It's in his bloodline. It's in his heart. And it's the belief that every child can be successful. And with that, in his ability, he portrayed that at South Platte. Because we tried to steal him from Phoenix. But every time we tried to get him over at Phoenix. Then I said, sometime I think you're best where you are. But you had a lot of kid people, but whatever. The school of Plaquemines Parish system is enriched with his efforts. Second to none. Bars none. And again, I thank him as a man and as a former student to take the initiative to come back home and set the tone for the kids, the young kids who have been deprived in Plaquemines Parish throughout the years, that their fate is within themselves of being successful. That, my son, I thank you for those commitments.
Hey, Carrie, from the newspaper, can you get a quick picture with all of us with the proclamation? Mr. Bartholomew, will you come up?
We hope that you don't have any other aspiration in the world of politics.
Thank you. Ms. Barb, will you read two proclamations?
A proclamation declaring November 26, 2016 is Harry Jones Day in the parish of Plaquemines.
Yes, I offer and request a unanimous second.
Second. Okay.
A proclamation proclaiming November 26, 2016 as Harry Jones Day in the parish of Plaquemines. Whereas on November 26, 1926, Harry Jones was born in Ostraco, Louisiana to Adeline Coleman and Gus Jones. And whereas Harry married the late Florence Coleman Jones and five daughters, Barbara, Carolyn, Henrietta, Rosemary, and Gloria Lee, were born of their marriage. And whereas he is now blessed with the love and affection of 15 grandchildren and a host of great-grandchildren. And whereas Harry Jones served as a proud member of the armed forces in World War II from 1944 to 1946. And whereas Mr. Jones was baptized in 1973 at First Mount Zion Baptist Church by his son-in-law, Reverend Kenneth M. Parker, and is presently a member of the Mount Olive Baptist Church. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed by the Plaquemines Parish Council, represented by its duly authorized chairman, Kirk M. Lapine, And by concurrence of the parish president, Ed Terrio, representing the Plaquemines Parish Government, that it hereby declares November 26, 2016 as Harry Jones Day in the parish of Plaquemines.
Ms. Albin?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I will be accepting this proclamation on behalf of the family. The family was unable to be here today, but there is a big plan of celebration on November 26th. Mr. Jones will be turning 91 years of age. And I thank you guys for the support. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Albin. Okay, Ms. Barber, will you read executive session, please? Well,
1A, the Parish of Plaquemines versus ConocoPhillips et al., 25th JDC, number 60-982, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus HHE Energy Company et al., 25th JDC, number 60-983, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus Exchange Oil and Gas Corp. et al., 25th JDC, number 60-984, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus LLOG Exploration and Production et al., 25th JDC, number 60-985, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus Equitable Petroleum Corp. et al., 25th JDC, number 60-986, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus Linder Oil Company et al., 25th JDC, number 60988, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus Riverwood Production Company et al., 25th JDC, number 60989, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus Hellas Oil and Gas Corp. Company et al., 25th JDC, number 60-990, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus BEPCO LP et al., 25th JDC, number 60-991, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus North Coast Oil Company et al., 25th JDC, number 60-992, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus Cascades Operating Company et al., 25th JDC, number 60-993, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus Goodrich Petroleum Company et al., 25th JDC, number 60-994, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus Devon Energy Production Company et al., 25th JDC, number 60995, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus Rosal Operating Company et al., 25th JDC, number 60-996, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus Palm Energy Offshore et al., 25th JDC, number 60-997, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus Great Southern Oil and Gas Company et al., 25th JDC, number 60-998, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus Hillcore Energy et al., 25th JDC, number 60-999, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus Apache Oil Corp. et al., 25th JDC, number 61-000, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus Campbell Energy Corp. et al., 25th JDC, number 61-001, Division B. The Parish of Plaquemines versus Total Petrochemical and Refinery et al., 25th JDC, number 61-002, Division B. Attorney Brandon Taylor, Councilmember Burt. Number 2, Plaquemines Parish Civil Service Commission et al. Versus Plaquemines Parish Council et al., 25th JDC Court, docket number 63-231, Division A. Attorney Danny Garrett, Councilmember Lapine. Number 3, prospective litigation involving former employee Paula Dove in regard to her layoff from Civil Service Department. Attorney Danny Garrett, Councilmember Lapine. Number 4, Fin and Feather LLC et al. Versus Plaquemines Parish Government et al., 25th Judicial District Court, docket number 56-844, Division A, Attorney Shane Landry and Councilmember Williams.
Items 1 through 4 have been offered in executive session. I'll ask for a second.
Second.
Second by Mr. Burt. Machine is open on executive session. With a 9-0 vote, we adjourn at 2:06. We come up. we come out of executive session at 2:46, finding no legal and binding action. We return to the agenda, to item six, the status report by the president. Mr. Terrio?
Mr. Chairman, due to the length of our agenda, I have no report, but I'll field any questions.
Okay, some questions?
Yeah, I have a question. I think we'd like to use this time, because I think it's been discussed about moving funds from one of the Sandy Act projects to another Sandy Act project, which is...
Yeah, and we have our district attorney and his investigator here to approach the council.
Thank you, Mr. Bailey. Will you come to the mic, please? Is it green?
Yeah.
Green light.
All right.
There you go. Testing. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, council members, Mr. President. Where do I start here? The building 201, as y'all know, out at the state school site has been designated a building for me to have renovated for an office. Been worked on for quite some time. For the longest time, it was an issue of getting the grants finally approved. That was a couple years, I guess I'd say. Finally done about last September or so of 2015. And then from there, finished plans, went through bidding process, bid one time, too high. We renovated or did some changes as much as we felt we could. Bid again recently, came in a month ago now, or 3 weeks or so ago, and still over what we had budgeted for it, what was anticipated, that is, for it. And so the question is, where do we go? Where do we do to proceed from here? Just a little bit of information. It's the building to be renovated is 13,020 square feet. The renovation project cost was going to be $3,230,000 and some odd dollars, basically $248 a square foot. And as a something to compare it to, at the courthouse being built, of course, right down here, the square footage of that $368, I think, a square foot. If my square footage, that is, had gone in there, it would have cost the project, of course, would have been $4,216,000 more if my office had gone in there in the square footage that we need. And that's not even including FF&E, furniture, fixtures, equipment, all that kind of stuff. So that would have been a cost that had been added to that bond or used up at that bond or something, and it's not there. So the funds right now in hand is two grant funds, HMGP, $616,000, and CDBG of $1.6 million, basically. And we'd appropriated from our office $264,000 some time ago to have the number that was projected to be the cost, $2.5 million roughly. The shortage now is $712,000 from the last bid. And my understanding, Jens is here, he'll be able to explain, but my understanding is from talking with the contractors on the first bid as well as this bid now, they seem to be good numbers. It doesn't seem to be overinflated numbers or problem numbers. And that's just what it is. By my luck or unluck, I guess one reason it's high is that the building that I have, and if y'all, I know y'all been on that site, y'all been to the finance building, it's the long building with the kind of the square end facing A-Bear, has a lot of glass. And I didn't know, or I don't know if anybody projected up front, that the renovation of those buildings, the mitigation requirements today, or the building requirements today, require a certain type of glass to be used, and it's expensive. And that's what is a lot of what this building is on the sides. We've cut back, try to figure a way to put more stucco, brick, or whatever you can do, and that's changed the cost, but not much, really just a little. And it's just the way the building is built, that kind of construction with those sides that it has. That's been part of the reason, and the mitigation money, the mitigation grant money, $616,000, I think that's the one that's woefully short for the way you're supposed to do it. It was like 300 and something thousand or so short of what that part of the project cost. So my request is to see if, of course, the funds could be obtained, because right now, actually, parish government council, of course, doesn't have any money going into it yet at all. and it's the two grants and monies from my office so far, and whereas if I would have the full office at the courthouse or anywhere else like that, it'd be a matter for parish government, for the council to fund, to build, to do. And so we're just trying to find a way, how can we get it done, is what our goal is, of course. We're presently at 201 Avenue G, the old permit engineering building. Of course, we flooded it more than a dozen times. One thing I do request, I mean, we don't have heat. We don't have a woman's bathroom. These things just haven't been fixed. Need the heat, please. I think it will get cold here sooner or later. We've been, I think, the hottest October ever record, but sooner or later we're going to get some chilly days and we have no gas, no heat. So we need that. Even if we're going to get this project going, it won't be done for quite some time, at least a year. So we'd like to get a few things done. So our request is to see if the funds, of course, could be found from different sources to do. As I mentioned, we put up $264,000 already. I anticipate the FF&E of my building in a neighborhood of $300,000. I think the council building being done close to us is around $350,000-$400,000. And so we know those are other costs, which we have always kind of thought, okay, we'd probably have to do that. But beyond that, it's not really possible for me to be able to handle. And so that's what our point is. And so if there are any questions of me or Mr. Nielsen, or if anybody else has anything else.
I'd just like to make one comment, Mr.
Chairman. Mr. Burt.
Mr. Bailey, I kind of agree with you. I've been back there several times in that area where your current building's at, and I must say it's embarrassing as a parish official and as a citizen to see the type of building that you're currently in back there. It's deplorable. It's just downright disgusting, not to your fault, but just where it's at on the toe of that levee. And, you know, I'm committed to doing whatever we have to do here at the council to make sure you guys get in a more acceptable building for your employees and yourself. So just thought I'd share those comments.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Burt. Anyone else? Boy?
No, I'll
Mr. Russo?
While we're on the subject of the building, I noticed this morning coming across, they're taking all of the dirt away from the back of the building. Is that going to help you from flooding anymore, or do you know?
I think it should. I mean, I've talked to Ken Dugas. In fact, when they first started doing some of the taking the mud away about 2 or 3 weeks ago, I called him. I said, look, these people have the equipment, the know-how. I said, have y'all gotten with them? He said, yeah, we met last week. We drew up a plan to do all that kind of stuff, so I hope they do. And, I mean, obviously when they finish the job, Conti seems to be an excellent contractor. The levy thing I think is going to come out great when it's done. So I think, you know, in a matter, I don't know, a month or so, I think they'd be done with that area. Hopefully they're planning and they're going to have enough space in the back to put a swale to come around to the front. Because the elevation in the back and the front, that's all they need to do is to make a swale, do an elevation shot, make it so the water comes around, because it's a good building. Whether I'm in it or the next guy or a detective bureau being right by the lockup or something, so it could be used by someone. And the building should be saved, because the amount of flooding, the amount of water that's been on all those baseboards, I don't think it's a good thing. And it should be done like this to be used by whoever. So I think we're anticipating, Mr. Russo, I think we're anticipating in a month that they should fix it. And hopefully with the engineering and other folks talking and working with them, it can be done. I think there's enough room back there. The problem before is when they put those concrete barriers, they were so close to the wall, the back of the building, they couldn't get in there with any kind of equipment. We talked about them doing it other ways, and nobody wanted to do it any other old manual way, I guess. And so they wanted to wait till they got it done, move the barriers, and have room to get a machine there to work it. And that's the plan, is what I understand.
Yeah, so my hope is that at least that'll fix it temporarily, or I mean fix the drainage issue, and hopefully the buildings department can get you some heat, because no matter what we decide here today, you're not going anywhere for a few months, I would imagine.
Yes, sir. And yeah, and the grass in the back, I mean, it's just, honestly, that's why I think we flooded so many times, because dirt would roll off that levee. They're doing a project, and it rolled back there, and nobody did any maintenance. The grass back, the thing is yay high most of the time. And I know it's an equipment world today, machines. You got to be able to get to it with that, otherwise it just kind of doesn't get done.
Yeah, I just want to bring up the actual funding issue. We've had multiple projects, and I've brought this to the administration's attention at the last council meeting, that have gone out for bid. And one, we received no bids for the project, or two, the bids that come in are 25% above what the engineer's estimate is. We've gotten multiple emails from surety companies and bid bond companies that the bid bond language, the way it's been changed by the legal department within the parish government, pretty much prohibits them from issuing a bid bond. And if a bid bond is issued, the contractor will then write that into the bid. So for your building, which probably should be $2.5 million, I'm just rounding this off, normally would be $2.5 million, would then be bid out at $3.5 million. I don't think it's in the best interest of the parish government to accept that and spend an extra $1 million of taxpayer money to pay for what I believe is an error in the legal department's assessment of how they're writing the language for the bid bond. So the root of the problem to me is the language in those proposals, particularly the bid bond language, and we've heard that from multiple contractors. We have a $7.5 million quadplex complex on FLA Bear property that we've already spent about $750,000 on design, engineering, et cetera, that went out to bid. We received no bids, but yet we had about 8 contractors actually come to the bid opening, and all of them spoke to the government officials who were at the opening to tell us that the bid bond language was the issue. So we're not getting competitive bids on any of these projects because of that language. And if we do get a bid, it's one or two bidders, and they're increasing their bids by 25%. So I don't think it's the right thing to do to just go ahead and accept that and swallow that 25% overcharge, like Mr. Bailey had just mentioned before. I'm not sure if we change the language on his bid, if it's going to reduce it by the $700,000 that it's over. It probably won't, but we may have a reduction, and we also may be able to open up a more competitive process for other projects. I mean, this is probably like the fourth time I've heard this on different projects that we're losing projects. And this is all, like he said, it's SRIA funded projects, it's FEMA projects, it's HMGP, CDBG. It's all those projects where we've either already matched the money or it's 100% grant. And we're just letting this money go to waste. And it's tough for me to, instead of correcting the root of the problem, to just say, let's just pay it. I mean, I've asked the administration to look into it. Mr. Burmaster, who wrote the language, disagrees with me. Therefore, I'd ask the council chairman to request direct the council attorney, Mr. Garrett, to give us his opinion on it before I would appropriate any money. And if he does come back and say that the bid bond language on Mr. Bailey's building is not the issue, then we can look at moving some money. I'm not sure if there's money available. I think there is a few bucks available in a couple different projects. For one, and I'll mention it here, is a SRIA project which we don't have enough funds for from the parish government side to fund the full completion of the project. I'm not sure how much we spent on it already, but we have about $500,000 in Sandiac money that we could move over. Potentially, it would take some work, and that's for the EOC project. So that would be my first option, but that's only $500,000, and I know you're looking for probably $1 million.
712, I think it is.
Does that 712 include 350 FF&E?
I'm sorry?
Does that 712 include the 350 of FF&E?
No, we were gonna pay for that.
Okay, so you're looking for about seven and a half. I got you.
We'd rather
try to fund it as best we can.
I understand. If I may, Councilman, the first bid had some numbers and some things in it as far as the surety and liquidated damages and the time of construction, and we met with, I know with
Mr. Terrio, and he agreed that for the second bid, we did change the language regarding, one, the time to construct, because it doesn't matter. I don't have to be in a spot at a certain date.
Right.
So we went from 260 maybe to 300 or something like that. We gave more time so the contractor wouldn't have to worry about liquidated damages. And we also changed, which was a big thing we'd heard from the contractors in the first bid, was a liquidated damage amount like this to make it more reasonable, as we understood, from all other kind of construction jobs in the area. Now, the surety stuff, no, that did not change. And I don't know for a fact on my building, this bid, how it really truly affected it. But I know in the quads, I did speak with a number of the contractors that were there, and they had surety calls that morning, said they're not gonna, they wouldn't do the job.
Right.
They wouldn't insure the jobs. So that was an issue with them on that. I can't really say for this one for certain, and how it affected that with the surety on the thing. But I do know we got liquidated damages down to what I understand is the norm or the general. And I think it was 1,000 a day from 5,000 a day or something like
right.
that. And we gave more time so a contractor wouldn't have to worry about is he even going to get in that area
right.
because we don't even, you know, they don't need to get there. So these grants I know have sunset times on them, and we just don't want to lose that money because if we lose that money.
I totally agree. And I don't want to defund the entire project that we've already spent $750,000 on to give it to another project. At this time, I think we have money, at least $500,000 we can probably move for you pretty quickly with the EOC project. I want to get to the root of the problem with the quad project and probably some of the problem with your project. I'm not saying go out to rebid it. I'm just asking Mr. Garrett to give us his opinion on it to see if Mr. Burmaster can maybe move towards the middle a little bit and we can reduce these issues and get to surety for these projects.
Because you know, it's 45 days, of course, from when the bid was, and that's about...
It was bid on October 18th.
Yeah.
And so there's a little time running now that can be extended, of course, upon
right.
agreement of the contract.
And I know this is the second time you went off a bid, and I know it's frustrating, very frustrating. It's frustrating for me because, you know, I go back there every day, and it's like Charlie said, I know you're talking about the other building, but those buildings are deplorable too. So, I mean, if we're going to defund or take funds from the quad project, I want to dissect that project if we can. I mean, if you need funds from that project in particular, we can build half that project, and that's what we need to talk to Bird, Dahl, and Graves about, to see if we can build half of it and take those funds and maybe replenish some of the parish funds that are in 203 and use some of that extra money, number one, to help out with your building, and number two, is to actually start cleaning up that complex. I mean, we have a lot of people that's going to be moving back there within the next probably year. If your project goes forward, it's probably a 15-month project. The council should be in our building by April timeframe. The administration, I think, may be moving back there as well after January. So we're going to have a lot of activity back there, and we need to get some of that stuff cleaned up. I mean, we have walkways that are hazards. People can get hurt. We have buildings that are just dilapidated and need to be torn down. So I would love to sit with you, Mr. Ballet, and with the administration, and kind of come up with a master plan of what we want to do with that complex and what funds are available. And I think that would be a good starting point for me.
Because the contractor on the low bid is the one that is doing the council building, so we always thought it'd probably be, and I think the job, as I understand, is going well, would be a good one to have. And so we really kind of hate to lose this bid, what we have right now. So we'd welcome to meet soon.
I agree.
And I know funds are, like I said, in other projects, and this is one that's
right.
you know, good to go if we can get it going.
Is $500,000 okay?
I don't know if the contractor would.
Well, you know, when we rebid the project last time, we made a substantial amount of cuts, and probably the max cuts you can make without not finishing part of the building. The one thing that we could probably look to value engineer with the contractor, and I had, you know, just thought about this in the last day or so, I haven't even discussed it with Charles, is to look at changing the roof a little bit, still put a metal roof on it, but get rid of some of the slope. You know, on most of those buildings are going to a 4 and 5 on 12.
Would that meet the criteria for HMGP?
Yes, it can still meet the criteria. It would still be a metal roof. It would just be lesser of a slope to get rid of most of the roof framing.
Right.
I mean, you know, to get the warranty on that type of roof, you need a 2 on 12. That current roof's probably a 1 on 12.
Look, I have no, if you can get it down to $500,000, I have no problem moving that ELC money, because, as you know, there's state funds involved in that as well, and I'm not sure what priority those funds are in, and, but the parish has a substantial match, and we can't match the money, so I don't want to lose the SRA, the Sandy Act money, and the state money.
I definitely don't think you have $212,000 you can save on that roof framing, but, you know, $150,000 might be.
Right.
You know, and...
Well, even with the alternates, too. I mean, the alternates were low. I mean, the alternates, I think, were like $75,000 total at the moment.
Yeah, they were, no, like $50,000.
Yeah, 63 and 55. Yeah.
And it's considerably more than $50,000 worth of work in those alternates. So if you're going to find the money, I definitely recommend that you find that extra $50,000 award those alternates.
The $500,000 is still remaining in the EOC?
Yes, no money's been spent on that.
Okay. Well, let's get. I say we just get together and find. And we have the parish president asked the engineer to give us a list of everything. We have those. I think they're pretty current. So we already have the paperwork that we need.
And just
to look
for
at
clarification, you know, if it is the parish's desire to take money from the Soria projects, that money can't be put directly to 201. That was not one of the original approved projects. But you have the CDBG money, which is funding both projects partially. You know, we would have to, or the parish's grant manager for CDBG would request of the state to move that amount of money from 203 to 201 to fund the difference, and then the Soria money would fund 203.
That's fine. I mean, 203 has probably five different funding sources, including ordinance money.
Yes.
So...
So it can be done. We believe it can be done. I know Joan Arsenault has had some preliminary conversations with the state. You know, and the parish can definitely make that, and it would probably get approved.
I'd rather use that money, Jones, because that project's not going to go forward, the EOC. We're going to run out of time on Sandy Act before we get parish money to fund the rest of that project. So I would shoot for that $500,000 first, and let's go from there. I mean... If anybody else has any objections, I mean, I think we need to get with the administration, Mr. Ballet and Jens and Ken.
Well, I mean, if that's the direction y'all want to go in, I can, you know, notify FEMA that it's intention to do away with that, with the EOC project.
Yeah. Well, there's no savings to rebid it, and Danny thinks that it's fine.
Well,
you know.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, I just say if Danny thinks it's fine the way it's written and there's no reason to rebid it, then we move forward with let's find the funds first, and then let Danny give his opinion. And if his opinion, if Melvin still doesn't want to change it, well, we'll come to that road, that bridge when we get to
it.
Yeah,
at this point on this particular building, I don't know that rebidding again, that surety issue costs a considerable amount of money.
Right, and if it doesn't, let's get that money first, and then we'll make a decision on that. So
on,
I'm
John.
Done.
Hold on, John. Danny first.
Just to follow up on the discussion about changing the surety and those things, I want to make sure that the attorneys that come to an agreement make every effort to protect the parish's interest on these bid projects because of the amount of litigation that we have on the buildings that we've already built. And, you know, without us putting ourselves out to be able to get stuck again, I wouldn't want to see that happen. So whether they or too high or too low or whatever, I hope that we come to an agreement on that.
Okay.
Well, and when 201 was first bid out, you know, one of the main concerns that was expressed by all the contractors was the amount of liquidated damages per day, that amount, and the insurance required, the amount of general liability insurance. Mr. Terrio and the legal department made that change, but there's still some language on the surety that all the surety companies are having issue with. Not in the amount, but just the language of the surety section within the front ends of the parish.
Mr. Terrio?
I just want to know, did the council member receive a package from Melvin Burmaster pertaining to insurance? Should have been sent to you guys yesterday.
Yeah, it might as well have been in Greek.
I'm not a lawyer, so we don't know about the Greek, but
it was a very detailed explanation of why they do what they
do. Because of all the litigation we have, because we didn't have, you go after the insurance company, they didn't have no insurance.
Right, but the problem is they're not even giving them the surety. I mean, that's like going to get car insurance and you can't find anybody to even insure you. They're saying, we're not insuring you. So, I mean, so you think that the surety, some calls the surety lobbies are focusing on Plaquemines Parish and saying, let's blackball Plaquemines Parish? I mean, I wouldn't think so. I mean, it seems like a far-fetched conspiracy theory to me.
I'll let your attorney look at it, and then we'll get together and try to hack it out again.
Mr. Bartholomew?
Yes, since it's such a controversial issue, I think you need to get a committee to sit down at the table and discuss that with these gentlemen from the table that represent this council, at least three, if not four, members from the table.
Okay.
I'll request that the president, as chairman of this council, appoint a committee.
Thank you, Mr. Bartholomew. You let you want to? Okay. Wait, it's the Henry.
Thank you, folks.
Hold up.
What's the value of going away? Yeah.
I'm right here.
You said building, you want to have 13,000 square feet?
Yes, sir.
Could you tell the public and the people how many square feet you going to have at the new courthouse right here?
1,500. It's a sub-office. It's got, I think, two meeting rooms, a conference room, and a small, probably, inside waiting room in there is what it should have. As last I recall, 1,500 square feet. Yes, sir.
Hey, love the guy. This is not nothing personal, but, man, I got to disagree with this building. When this was proposed to build this courthouse, that 13,000 square feet should have been in a new courthouse.
Guess what, Mr. Henry? That's why I voted against it.
Oh.
Because it wasn't. We should have built it bigger.
No. Hold on.
The request of people that
said so. I have a point. Mr. Black, you were on the council then when it was proposed. Craig was on that. Hey, that 13,000 square feet should have been in a courthouse. Now, I have no problem with you having a building, but that shouldn't be your main office. You shouldn't have a little sub office at the main courthouse, which is the DA functioning that I know of. I just don't think you should have a satellite office there. I think your main office should be there. And have a satellite office somewhere else. That's my opinion, and I think when the people voted, that's kind of like what they voted on, you know. But it's not nothing personal. It just the way I feel, it should have been done.
Thank you, Ms. Henry.
I have a question. I'm just trying to understand if the total charge for this is in the $2 million range, and now we're asking for an additional $750,000. And so I don't understand what that's for. And then I heard some talk about changing the slope of the roof. My other question is, if you change the slope of the roof, that's dramatically changing the scope and of the work product. So wouldn't you have to rebid the project if you make that kind of change? What is the extra $750,000 for? Is this a change order, or is this? Okay.
It's the bid of the bid came in at 3,230,000.
Over what was budgeted?
Yeah, correct.
Okay, that's what I wasn't getting.
And that's what it is. So that's not a change. I'm sorry. Okay. It's not a change order or anything, and that's where it is. And so yeah, if you change the roof, if you change any. This council, everybody well knows, of course, if you change any plans, any really very much at all, actually, you got to rebid it. And so if the roof thing would be done, it would have to be. And I just, my feeling on that would be that y'all designing and y'all getting a really nice governmental campus out there, I don't know if you really want your buildings all kind of different ways. To me, it just doesn't go with what you should be doing out there. You're creating a nice campus, a nice setting. And so I guess I have to see what they... Sometimes I like to see things on paper, what things look like or something. But anyway, no, I appreciate that, and that's where we are.
Thank you. Oh, Ms. Salvan?
Yes. The only thing I would like to say to this is that I, to Mr. Nielsen, Mr. Valley, is that I wish you would have put as much effort as you're putting in securing funding for the DA's office into securing funding for the Port Alpha Library. Maybe the folks would have got the type of library that they were entitled to.
Thank you, Ms. Alvin.
Yeah, I just want to answer Ms. Brandon's question. And no, I do agree with you, Mr. Valley. I think those buildings need to stay cosmetically consistent. I think we need to have, you know, I don't want mixed match stuff back there, but no, I agree with that. So basically, the engineer's estimate was like $2.5 million, and they both, all the bids came in at 3.2. So that's where the extra $700,000 comes from.
Yeah, I would just add to that that the council building itself, I think you'll have to appropriate $200,000 or $300,000 more than what was anticipated. And of course, the council found the money and appropriated to get that contract going. And I guess things just cost more than some people are realizing. And I should have said earlier, too, part of the problem we think with bidding right now is with the flooding that was in central Louisiana, it's hard to find contractors and mainly mechanical subcontractors. They're quite busy up in that region. They have all the work they want to do, job to job, right next door to each other. And that's a big problem we're having right now is to get people to bid. And as I mentioned, mainly the mechanicals, the sub people, are difficult to find right now. And that's, and so it's their market in a sense as opposed to the way it used to be.
All right, Mr. Juneau?
Yes. You were saying about...
What's so important about those minutes?
Can they be changed out? Because I know... There's something wrong with these mics. They keep going on and off. Anyway, the vendors we have, when one of the lawnmowers spill out a rock, it breaks. So it's not no special vendors. I mean, they just cheapy vendors, but they're charging you a lot of money, as far as I'm concerned. So you can check on that. That would cut off at least a couple $100,000. Get rid of them vendors.
Yeah, I mean, they obviously have to have the specs, whatever they are. And I'm the way I always heard all these things, the Dade County specs and, you know, certain codes you have to meet.
See the windows we have and go back by the permit office because four of them windows are broke from a lawnmower with a little rock. So they're not no special windows.
And they're supposed to be able to take a 2x4, I think. But
yeah, well, you can't take a little rock.
No, I understand.
Mr. Dugas.
I just wanted to mention the roofing component, by changing the roofing component, the funds for the roof, the doors, and the windows are strictly funded by HMGP. By changing the roofing component to try to save money, all you're doing is reducing the HMGP funds. So I don't see the savings to the project because the HMGP funds cannot be used for any other part of the project. So if you reduce the wind retrofit, you can't use it for renovation. So.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Dugas. Any other questions?
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bell.
Thank you all very much.
Okay. Mr. Terrio, any more else? Any address? Present. That's it. Any other questions from the table on the presidential address? Audience? We'll move on. Ms. Barber, we'll move on to item 6C. Would you read 6C?
A resolution to provide employees group coverages consisting of health, dental, vision, and life for the policy period of January 1, 2017 through December 31, 2017 on an employer-employee contributory basis of 72%/28% and otherwise provide with respect thereto.
I'm going to offer with a substitute that's being passed around. I'll offer and ask for a second. Second by Ms. Williams. This is a substitute, the ordinance that's on the table. Like all Mr. Wayne, Danica, whoever wants to come up and explain this is the quote with the Blue Cross, Blue Shield, all of it. Mr. Wayne?
Thank you very much. Wayne Fursang, I'm with Gallagher Benefits, and Danica Ansardi is my partner on the case. Essentially, this is going to break down into two sections. One is on the medical side, which is the Blue Cross Health Plan. And the Blue Cross Health Plan originally received a 3% rate increase. That was since reduced down to 1.5% rate increase. So from a standpoint of dollars and cents, the actual cost to the council, better yet, I'll talk in terms of the gross cost right now. And the gross cost would have been $5,633,000. And that 1.5% increase would have raised the cost to $5.7 million, okay? With that, well, the marketplace produced two plans that came back. One was totally non-competitive with Aetna, which would have raised the cost to over $350,000. And one from United that just said, we are non-competitive and we're not even going to submit a proposal. But then Humana Healthcare came in with a proposal that brought the cost down to $5.435 million. That was roughly a savings in the neighborhood of about $143,000. The breakdown is really at the point where if we look at the cost to Blue Cross and to Humana, if it's purely a dollar and cent decision to be made, there's no question that Humana Healthcare is the program to switch to. We tried to get as close to the Blue Cross plan as we possibly could, but there's nothing that's going to be exact. It's going to be as close as we possibly can get. There may be some different physicians, there may be different drugs in different tiers of coverage, but for the most part, financially, that is the lowest cost. So the decision is really based on what it is that you're looking to try to do here. Disruption to employees by switching carriers, it's always an issue, but like I said, we tried to get as close as we could. We did a comparison of physicians, and about 80% of the doctors that, of the top 100 doctors that are used by the Plaquemines Parish employees are in, with Humana, are in the Blue Cross network. So for the most part, the greater majority of people will have their physicians available to them. Some may have to switch carriers. We tried to do a comparison of the drugs that people use. Unfortunately, the two drug lists are not ready yet. They will be coming out in the middle of December for Blue Cross and probably in the next couple of weeks for Humana. So from that standpoint, we think the drugs will be close, but there will be some differences. Some people that have drugs today that are in the Tier 2 rank will be moved to Tier 3 with Humana. But there will be others that are in Tier 3 with Blue Cross that would move to Tier 2 with Humana. So that's a toss of the coin to see where you go from there. So with that in mind, we're looking at an actual increase of 1.5% to a reduction of 3.53% on the medical side. Any questions on that?
For clarification, the one that we introduced a substitute, that's the exact same insurance we have right now. Same carrier, same insurance.
That is Blue Cross of Louisiana. Yes, sir. It's the exact same
exact
plan
insurance.
Just moving over. Now, there were some changes.
There'd be no change. No change in coverage.
Well, so one of the changes that is going to take place is in the emergency room. The emergency room coverage is actually going to be increased from $150 to $350. That is just a change that went across with Blue Cross. So we didn't have anything to do with it, and it wasn't something that just happened to Plaquemines Parish government. This is an increase that was put in by the Blue Cross physicians and the Blue Cross team. So that is the major individual change in benefits for that plan. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Black.
Okay, so we went through the changes. I appreciate that, and it's very minimal. So now let's get to dollars and cents.
Yes.
Because I'm against the resolution as it's been offered. Mm-hmm. I am for the Humana plan because of one main reason. It's about a net savings of $300,000 to the parish government. I mean, can you go through and if we stay with Blue Cross, how much are we going to have to go up from what we paid in 2016? Around $60,000? How much was?
we're going up $55,000.
Okay, so it's going to cost us $55,000 more.
Correct.
To stay with Blue Cross.
Yes.
If we go with Humana, how much is it going to be reduced from 2016?
If we go with Humana, the reduction is about $143,000.
Okay, $143,000 is what we're going to reduce it, but the net savings is $198,000. Is that correct?
If you add the $55,000 from the increase to Blue Cross, yes, sir.
Right, so we'll be saving net $198,000. Not to mention, I think when Mr. Serpas put it in the budget, there was a 5% overage to cover. And I'm not sure exactly what that is, but I think that's close to $100,000.
We're actually, it winds up being 3.5 because we built in 5% and the increase was 1.5.
Okay, so that 3.5, guys, it's not obviously real money, but it's money that comes back to the budget, which is about, what do you think, 100?
I would say probably about 100, 110,000.
Okay, so the total net savings by going to Humana would be a net savings of over $300,000. Now,
according to those calculations,
okay.
Yes.
I mean, that's Apple iPhone calculation there, but I mean, $300,000, that's quite a few jobs. I mean, that's quite a few jobs. And the only change between going from Blue Cross to Humana is a prescription change, possibly, with Blue Cross. The doctors, as you said, majority of them will say the same. I mean, to me, I'm not sure, and I think the discussions I've had with HR, if we vote on it today and change it, they can get the cards and everything out in enough time.
Ms.
Williams?
Now, these figures are based on current employees, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
The rates?
Yes, ma'am.
And it's my understanding that Blue Cross has guaranteed if we have a reduction in the workforce, the premiums will remain the same.
Yes, ma'am.
Humana cannot guarantee that. Correct?
To the extent of there's a formula that they use for changes to come back to allow them to have the right to re-rate the case. We've met with them, and they feel pretty confident that those numbers would be tough to get to, and
that's my only concern with changing to Humana. I do understand the savings, but in the long run, if we reduce our workforce, we may not be saving as much.
But we're not gonna, I mean, the discussions I've had, we're talking about maybe $50,000, so we're still saving like $50,000.
It's minimal.
It's not $300,000. I mean, even if it was $200,000, I'd still be for it. I mean, this is net $300,000, and the worst case scenario, maybe $250,000. But I mean, this is a when we're talking about making government more lean and more efficient, a $300,000 savings in insurance to me is substantial. I mean, that's a lot of hard work that they've done, and I appreciate it, and they've spent a lot of time with us.
But like you said, you've spoken with HR, and they'll have time to get all of this out to our employees as far as insurance causing goes before the first of the year? I mean,
I've spoken to Ms. Horton. I think,
That's why today is important, because it would give us an opportunity to start immediately to make whatever changes we need to switch over to a new carrier. And we can make that still happen at this point.
And that is your recommendation, to go with Humana?
Well, again, what we've always tried to do is to lay the facts out for you, and you know, you guys know what you're looking to try
Correct.
To do. And if it's to provide the lowest cost, then it's Humana.
With the same,
Basically the same coverage, never going to be exactly
right,
the
correct.
Same. There may be some disruption.
Correct.
But from the lowest cost standpoint, it's Humana. And then from a standpoint of no disruption, keeping everything going, $55,000 of more cost. Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, but we are saying low cost to the government, but what was to be the premium difference for the employee? By going with Humana.
Oh, Humana, about $7 a month.
Say. It's between $5 and $6 a month reduction going from Blue Cross to Humana. But that's on a single person on the HMO. The difference is about $6 or $7, yes.
Okay.
Any more questions from the table?
I never asked you this question when we had the meeting. But if someone's in a hospital right now and they're under roof cross, you might have to stay there. Let's hope they don't, for a couple of months. What'll happen there?
What winds up happening is if somebody at the end, on December 31st at 12 o'clock, if somebody is still in the hospital, the carrier who is in force, who is at before the clock to turn to 12 o'clock, is the carrier that would stay on the hook for whatever the bill is until that person left the hospital. So it would be Blue Cross going forward. Until that person got out of the hospital, then it would revert back from that point forward.
Say they have cancer and they send home in hospice, what happens then? They still got to cover?
Well, then Humana picks up that cost. Once they go back home, then Humana would pick up that cost.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, I would ask that this one be deferred and not deferred, but what I don't understand.
Well,
I can't defer it. We have to act today.
No, well, I don't have to act today. I think it's in the resolution form,
and I think if we put this one up, we can do one under.
No, I don't want to defer it. What I want to do is this is for Blue Cross. What I'm saying is move the second, and then move to the Blue Cross, move to the Humana, and vote on that one. And then if it doesn't pass, then we come back to Blue Cross. Instead of just killing Blue Cross, let's remove the second, move to the Humana, vote on Humana.
Do we have all the accurate figures for Humana?
Yes.
We do have that one.
Yeah, we just discussed that at length before.
All right, Ms. Williams, will you remove your second? And I'll offer this as a substitute. Okay, Mr. Francisco.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Which one was the plan that you were talking about? All of Humana, or Humana that's separated with the Sun Life?
Well, that's the second part of this. We have non-medical coverage, and that is made up of dental, vision, and life insurance. Okay? We have proposals in here from Sun Life, from Humana, from Blue Cross, and from Delta Dental as a third submitter. But they're on the high side, so really not to be considered. At this point, there are reasons to go with Sun Life as the cover, the carrier for the non-med policies. And one of the reasons there is that Sun Life already has your life insurance. Right now, their renewal is a 5% rate increase. All right, we had a terrible year the last 2 years. And essentially, they were originally coming in with a 13% rate increase. We were able to get it down to 5%. But they said if they were able to get the dental and the vision, then the dental and the vision would allow us to go to a no rate increase, which would actually save us about $7,000 on the life insurance. So if you went with Humana and Sun Life, the total cost would be the savings. The total savings of Humana Medical and then all of Sun Life for the dental vision and the life would be about $189,000. Okay? But Humana came back and said, if you allow us to have the dental and the vision, we will give you another discount to the tune of about $20,000 on the medical insurance. And the medical insurance along with the dental and the vision, and then we would go back to the higher cost on the life insurance, the savings would be about $196,000. So Humana with Sun Life life insurance, but Humana having dental and vision is almost $200,000. And then the Humana with all of Sun Life is about $190,000. Not a whole lot of difference, but That's what's on the table for you to look at on the non-med.
So Humana with med, Humana Dental Vision, and I mean, we're talking about a net of $300,000.
Right at it, yes.
Okay.
Now, that's not adding all your calculations that you did before.
Right. So even more money.
Okay. I withdraw the resolution to substitute.
This is the one you just passed out is for all Sun Life. That's Do you have another one?
That was the one with the $196,000, right?
No, that's $189,000. No,
that is the Sun Life.
It's from Ms. Kim, and I'm not throwing under the bus.
Another one.
All right, this is the one. Hold on. The one that was handed to us. All right. This one as a substitute.
I got one more question.
Yes, sir. Can you read it?
Yeah, we think we gave it to you.
Mr. Francine.
Yes, sir.
Now,
do I need a second?
Whoever we go with, they cannot change in the next year. They got to stay like they are. They can't go up. Am I right?
Well, in the case of Humana, we're in that same boat, but they feel pretty confident that we won't get to the threshold that would cause the rate to be increased.
All right. The reason I said this, I had mentioned it to you before, with the retired people under Humana, Humana's just raising everyone's insurance up $33 with the Medicaid.
That's the Humana Medicare Advantage plan,
right?
Correct.
They're going up $33 on the old people like I am, you know? But I'm just saying that's what I'm worried about, you know?
That is something totally separate and apart.
I know that, but if they do that, they can also do this. That's what I have.
Now, we only have, the rate is only guaranteed for 1 year on the medical.
Yeah.
Now, we have 2-year rate guarantees on the dental for Humana, and we have, for Humana's vision plan, we've got a 3-year rate guarantee. So for the next 2 years, this year and next year, no increase on dental, and then for 3 years, no increase on vision, and then we have a 2-year rate guarantee on Sun Life's life insurance policy. So we're pretty much locked into as many guarantees as we can get.
Okay.
All right.
You offered?
The substitute's been offered on the table.
I'll second.
Second by Mr. Black. And this is on the Humana and Sun Life. Is there any questions on this one?
I just want to make sure we're voting on the right one. This says it's a quota of Humana at $450,000 per month or $5.4 million per year. The best quote for dental was submitted by Humana at a cost of $27,000 per month or $330,000 per year. And the best quote for vision insurance was submitted by Humana at a cost of $5,931 or $71,000 per year. And the quote for life by Sun Life at a cost of $13,000 or $158,000 a year.
That's the one.
All right.
And we are assured, not to put you on the spot, that we can get this out by the 1st from our human resource.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other questions?
Mr. Lapine.
All right.
Mr. Lapine.
Mr. Freeman.
The question I have is anyone currently in the savings plan or is it offered by the old insurance versus the new insurance, and how will that transfer from one to the other?
Well, there is a high deductible health plan that's going to be offered at the same time. We have a third plan in with our current Blue Cross program. We have gotten as close to that third plan as we can, but there's no one in that plan. That plan is essentially set there because of its low premium, and it's offered to everybody, so everybody can enroll into it, but it's a high deductible plan. It's a $2,500 deductible. Actually, it's actually a higher deductible than that. It's $4,000 of deductible. It's a $4,000 deductible before anything is covered at all except wellness. So very few people are going to take it, but it wasn't put in there for the purpose of offering a great plan. It's in there because of having the ability to offer a low premium that we can offer an affordable plan according to the mandate under ACA.
And back to the question that Mr. Juno asked about, because I'd been through this insurance thing years ago, and when we were going to change before, we talked about changing from one plan to the other and coming that midnight hour in December, and that person's in a hospital. If they're in a hospital that doesn't honor the insurance that we're taking now, that would be a grave concern to me. But who's going to work out all those little, is that person going to be on the hook for it, or is someone from administration, is HR, is the insurance representatives going to represent that person in that one case that may happen?
Well, I don't know of any of the hospitals in the area that are not in either network, that all of the major hospitals are in the networks. So I don't see a difference there.
But we did see just a while back, less than a year ago, where some hospitals didn't honor one insurance.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you there.
Less than a year ago, we saw where some hospitals stepped back from some insurances, and they were turning them down. So some people were left in a dark hour there, not knowing that they could go back to those hospitals. So I know you're putting in an surety in your own voice of what you can lock in for the year, but I do know how these insurance companies work, and there is an entry fee, and once you're in, they have you. So an increase could come nationally, and we would fall right into that increase. And you know that as well as I do, and I'm not wanting you to misrepresent yourself, but when Mr. Lapine asked for a security from you that you could lock it in at a price, I think that's a hard statement to stick to for the complete year or the two-year period, because we could be on the cusp of a national increase with the company we're getting ready to take.
I am not aware that I know I've never seen it in my 45 years in the business here. I've not seen where a rate guarantee has been given that it wasn't honored through the year. I've just never seen it, and I'm not aware of any of them that has happened that way, to be quite honest. Now, depending on the carrier, if you have a carrier that's a startup carrier, we had a whole lot of people that when they opened up the exchanges for the healthcare reform, a lot of new companies were able to get money from the federal government and go into business to be competitive with all the major carriers. A lot of those companies are gone as of now, especially the ones here in Louisiana. So, you know, if they were in one of those, then I would think that the Department of Insurance would have a way to make sure that anybody that's left in a bad way would have an opportunity to get their way out. I can't guarantee that, but I'm just telling you, I haven't seen what you've just described.
Well, I understand that, but the only thing, I guess, I look at two things. I look at what I hear, and then I look at the employees of the parish, and we have not got merit raises or any type of raises in the last couple of years, and now we're talking about something that may put a couple dollar increase for medicine or a doctor visit or something that changes that they're used to doing. So anytime you look at an insurance change, to me, that's one of the most gravest decisions that we have to make as councilmen. So I hope prudence and due diligence has been put into this thing. And I know you represent us. I hope the best interest of the parish is at heart. And I just want this to go the right way, because we got a lot of people right now that aren't getting that increase every year that they're used to getting. They're not getting the overtime, so when this comes around in a check and they got to make a doctor's visit, if we're truly out here for the people of Plaquemines Parish, we have to look at that too. That's all I have.
Okay. Any other question? Machine is open. And the resolution passes 9-0.
I want to just thank Wayne, Danica, Bridget. I mean, you guys just saved the parish over $300,000, and I appreciate all the hard work, and I know you met with the council quite a bit, so thanks a lot. Appreciate it.
Appreciate it. Thank you very
thank
much.
Thank you, Wayne. All right. We'll revert back to item 3, beer and liquor license. Mr. Bartholomew?
Yes, sir.
Fix Place LLC, Terrence Reddick, P.O. Box 104, Point Lash, Louisiana. DJ's One Stop Darrow Domain, P.O. Box 354, Point Lash, Louisiana. Ferry Stop, Irvin True, 1855 Highway 39, Braithwaite, Louisiana. Byron Williams, I'm sorry, B&V Blue Room, Byron V. Williams, Highway 15, 12925 Phoenix, Louisiana. That's all, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Mathon. Mr. Black?
Yes, I have three and a special events permit. The special events permit is for Paws at Numericals Unreadable, F. Edward Hebert Boulevard. It's at the Paws facility. 455. Clubhouse Bar and Grill, 8133 Highway 23 in Belchase. A&T Brothers Holding, Asahi Sushi Bar, 102 Woodland Highway. Hero Lands Company, Bayou Barrier Golf Club, 428 Planters Canal Road in Belchase. That's all.
Thank you. Mr. Juneau?
Yes, I have six. Lady Grace Seafood, 910 Jason Drive, Belchase, Louisiana. Maria's Restaurant, 8475 Highway 23, Belchase, Louisiana. Let's see. What is this one? Jody Camacho, 9080 Highway 23, Belchase, Louisiana. JMM Incorporated, Belchase Self Serve, 106 Morning Glory, Belchase, Louisiana. Blue Angel Lounge, 9670 Highway 23, Belchase, Louisiana. Psycho K, Belchase, Louisiana, 9144 Highway 23. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Juneau. Russo?
Yes, I have six also, but before I introduce them, I want to thank Dan Garrett, our attorney, for getting us back on track to the original ordinance of the time frame of when these licenses are supposed to be renewed. If you remember in the past, we've done these all in January, which is contrary to the ordinance that's been on the book for many, many years, actually. So now we are doing the way it's supposed to be done. Thank you, Dan. I have State Oil Fuel Center located at 7124 Highway 23, Belchase. Have another State Oil Fuel Center located at 7124 Highway 23 in Belchase. Have another one, Dave's Beverage at 7690 Highway 23 in Belchase. I have Salvo's Seafood LLC located at 7742 Highway 23. Lynn Nguyen located at 10830 Highway 23 doing business as N&L LLC. And Big Drink LLC located at 106 Barrier Road, better known as the Suds Tavern.
I have one. New Orleans Original Daiquiris, 8102 Highway 23, Belchase, Louisiana. Mr. Burt?
I have two. Captain Larry's Inc., 11334 Highway 23, Belchase, Louisiana, 70037. Phyllis Sack, 12753 Highway 23, Belchase, Louisiana, 70037.
Ms. Salvant?
Yes, I have two, sir. Happy Lane Chew, 27910 Highway 23, Port Sulphur, Louisiana. Delta Drugs of Port Sulphur, 26852 Highway 23, Port Sulphur, Louisiana. B&H Beverage, Barry and Akira Alexis, 114 Azalea Drive, Port Sulphur, Louisiana.
Thank you, Mr.
Yes, sir. Fellowship Bay Shop, 32082 Highway 23, Empire. Watusi, 33115 Highway 11, Empire. Lucky Ryan, LLC.
let's see, what's here? 109 Rhodey Lane in Burris, and Express Food and Fuel, 14715 Highway 23 in Belchase. That's all I have, sir.
Ms. Williams, I saved the best for last.
I have 13.
Okay. We're going down now.
Cypress Cove Marina, 235 Cypress Cove Road, Venice, Louisiana. Cypress Cove Grill, LLC, 226 Cypress Cove Road, Venice, Louisiana. Venice Marina, 237 Sports Marina Road, Suite A, Venice, Louisiana. Deep Delta Houseboats, LLC, 237 Sports Marina Road, Venice, Louisiana. Bayou Club Bar and Grill, 42866 Highway 23, Venice, Louisiana. The Den Lounge, LLC, 42805 Highway 23, Venice, Louisiana. Hearts Exxon, 42813 Highway 23, Venice, Louisiana. Hearts Old Cypress Bar, LLC, 42815 Highway 23, Venice, Louisiana. Adams Grocery of Bootville, Inc., 41245 Highway 23, Bootville. Philisac of Jesuit Bend, Inc., 113 Lions Club Lane, Bootville. Iguana Zachary Express, 123 El Dorado Street, Burris. Happy Land, 35949 Highway 11, Burris. Black Velvet Oyster Bar and Grill, 105 Everard Lane, Burris. And that's all, sir.
Thank you. I'll offer all these liquor license and global and ask for a second. Second by Ms. Williams. All of them. Any questions on it? Machines open on the license. And it's granted 9-0. There's no objection. Can we take 1 and 2 in global of the building permits? Any objection? Ms. Barb, huh? Take 2 separate? Okay, well, let's do them separate then. Well, 2, all right. Let's do 1 first, Ms. Barb.
Chevron Ornite Company, LLC, application number 2016-224, dated March 9, 2016. To replace pilings and drift deflector, Chevron Ornite Plant, Belchase, Councilmember Burt.
Mr. Burt, you offering? Offer. Second by Ms. Edgecombe. Any questions? Machines open on the permit. It's granted 8-0. Number 2, Ms. Barber.
Upstream Exploration, LLC, application number 2016-666, dated August 2nd, 2016. Dredge slip, install pile clusters and drill the Palmetto Prospect E, install wellhead protector line heater platform, 2 3-inch pipelines, second 2 2-inch gas lift lines, California Bay, Councilmember Bartholomew.
Bartholomew, offering? Ask for a second. Oh, wait. Ms. Irvin, you said second?
Yeah.
Okay, Irvin, second. Any questions? Machines open. And it's granted 7-0. 4A3, Ms. Barber.
Geoengineers, application number 2016-765, dated September 16, 2016. Drill 6 oil borings and perform 2 cone penetrometer, I can't get that one out, meter test for future installation of a 20-inch pipeline west and east Point of Lahash area in Mississippi River. Council members Bartholomew and Trufant Salvand.
Yeah, offer. Mr. Edgecombe, second.
I'll be present, not voting on this one, sir.
Okay, present. Any questions? Machines open. And it's granted 6-0. Move to 4B.
TLC Novelty William Hall, new fireworks stand, 8480 Highway 23, Belchase, Louisiana. Councilmember Lapine.
I'll offer. Ask for a second. Second by Ms. Edgecombe.
Can I say something?
Yes, sir.
This is the same thing that happened at the last meeting. We have another fireworks stand being voted on in Belchess, and I can't vote on it, but I will try to get a moratorium in the next, at the next meeting so we can stop all this. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Juneau. Mr. Terrio.
Mr. Chairman, hopefully the council member got a list of all the presently permitted and the ordinance, you know, because we had some discussion about a moratorium.
Okay. Any other question?
Yeah, until a moratorium is put in place, I have to vote for it because I can't discriminate against any one particular body that's... I don't like all these fireworks stands either, but they're following the rules, so until we have a moratorium.
Okay. Any other
question? I mean, the legislation that's on the table, who's enforcing what's already on the table?
The ones that are existing now, the renewals?
Right.
I think it's the permit office, huh? They got to fill a permit every year? But I mean, this is a new one, but the existing ones.
They're actually supposed to renew twice a year, once for each holiday event. Now, I can tell you we're having some problem getting everybody at the table to come in and do that. And I have, in meetings with the administration and the parish president, I've kind of been at the forefront of conversations and in favor of taking a look at our fireworks ordinance and revamping it and making some changes according to the council's input, the administration. So whatever the permit office could do to aid in that, we stand ready. We see some inconsistencies and some problems with it, and especially at times when fees are important. So
currently, the renewals should be each holiday that they open, correct?
Correct.
And is that the honor system?
Actually, Mr. Chairman, here's the ordinance, and if it's not much more than that from what I can personally see in the ordinance. I know Mr. Landry's looked at it too, and I'm a firm believer, and maybe we need to take a look.
Okay.
So
we'll
offer my assistance however
we'll
I can.
We'll revisit that, yes. Any other question? Yes, sir. Mr. Freeman.
Question, please. Someone said there's a moratorium. No.
No.
There's not?
No.
Y'all considering that? Because years ago, there was one in 2, 3, and 4, the districts. It was put in place. After I left office, it was lifted. I don't know who lifted it. But all of a sudden, we started having a bunch of fireworks stands in the upper end of the parish. That's why when the new one came up the other day, the new stand, I sat here and listened to it. And somebody questioned that it was a new stand. I don't think they voted for it. And I'm just under the impression a whole bunch of them came in right after that. And now we're working one in every now and then. So we left the lower end of the parish open because they never had that many. They didn't have it. So the East Bank, we had a couple stands there. But I would only hope, owning a house in Belchase and not sitting in the position I am, I'm speaking as a constituent, that someone would look out for the safety of my home. Because where I live, they come to the end of the road and they buy all the fireworks at the stands in Belchase, and they come from outside the parish and they pop them. So the back gates of the base has been kind of an open, it's like Gun City when it opens up. But I know if I drove my truck to Springwood or any other subdivision that's prominent, and I went out and parked in front of somebody's house and unloaded my $500 worth of fireworks and started popping them, that we would hear all kind of complaints in here. So I would only hope that when we sit in these positions, that we listen to everything other than just somebody wanting to open a stand. Because when you really look at what we get in tax fees and what we get in permit fees, it's zero. It's nothing. It's minuscule. One home burns down. It will never replace that. So what you're bringing to the table with fireworks, because we got fireworks coming from outside the parish. It comes in here every holiday. Not only sold here, but it comes from outside our parish. I would only hope you consider that in the future.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah, Mr. Freeman, that's exactly my concern. That's what I was alluding to in my initial question. So are we going to make the rules and put legislation in place to allow this, and then going to have to rely on the sheriff department to enforce it? How did this work? If someone go out in their driveway, they own their own property, but then if they're injecting a firework on somebody else's home, well, I mean, where's the enforcement? I mean, it's obvious that the sheriff's department can't go out and monitor everybody that's shooting fireworks, but still, we need to be mindful of what we're doing, and I agree with you 100%.
Well, if I know we have a moratorium in my district and it's not going to be sold and it's not going to be popped, I'll be the one to call police and tell them to come out and enforce it. The permit office would enforce any new fireworks stands not coming into those districts. So if you would choose not to have it in your district, you should be able to have the ability to choose not to have it in the district, not to be sold and not to be popped, designated areas. Whether it be out on the River Road in District 1 or 2, somewhere on some dead-end road, wherever you would designate it. But this is why they come to the lower of Barrier Road, because they can't go in Jefferson Parish and pop them everywhere.
Mr. Russo?
Yeah, I made comments at the last time we renewed one of the fireworks stands, and again, what we have to do, in my opinion, and ask the permit department to look at is how we are going to regulate the use, because the sale is separate and can be bought in Gretna, as he just stated, and come to Plaquemines and pop all you want. So until we get to the real problem of how they're used and what's used, the sale is not going to be the answer.
And Councilman Russo, I think you're absolutely right. I mean, we can brush up the ordinance and polish it and dress it up and make it the best ordinance in the world, but the use and the enforcement,
right,
and how these things are regulated out in real time is really the crux of the matter when it's New Year's Eve and you know, people are trying to sleep or you know, the 4th of July or what have you. So, and I know, just for the record, that our fire authority, local fire authorities, have expressed concerns too. So, whatever that's worth.
All right. Any other questions? Machine is open on the permit. And it's granted 7 with 2 no votes from District 4 and District 5. All right, move to item 5, introductions. Mr. Bartholomew?
Yes. An ordinance to authorize the Department of Engineering Plans specification permit application to for the closure of Mardi Gras Pass and to authorize Frank New LLC to provide engineering services for the project, and appropriate the funds to implement the engineering work pursuant to thereto. An ordinance authorizing the emergency exception of hiring freeze currently enacted on all position of Plaquemines Parish government otherwise to provide respect thereto. That's all, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Black?
Yes, I have one. An ordinance to amend the 2016 General Fund Operating Expenditure Budget, Flood Control Department, and otherwise to provide respect thereto.
Thank you.
None.
Thank you. A few. An ordinance to amend the General Fund 2017 Operating Budget by authorizing the transfer of $3,103,150 from the Bond Indebtedness Fund balance due to the unreserved undesignated fund, and that said funds are designated for the payment of the 2017 bond indebtedness and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. An ordinance authorizing acceptance of donation for the Homeland Security Emergency Preparedness Department and to amend the General Fund 2016 Operating Revenue and Expenditure Budgets, Homeland Security Emergency Preparedness Department, and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. An ordinance to amend the 2016 General Fund Operating Expenditure Budget, Self-Insurance Department, and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. A resolution authorizing and directing the parish president or his designee
to do all things necessary and proper to negotiate, execute, perfect, and enforce any and all documents required to apply for local government assistance program from the Office of Community Services in the amount of $100,000 to purchase zero-turn mowing machines and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. That's all. Mr. Burt?
I have several. An ordinance to amend the five-year capital improvements plan for the Jezero Bend Drainage Project and the planning slash design Oakville to La Receipt Back Levy Project and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. A resolution to elect the chairman of the Plaquemines Parish Council for the year 2017 and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. A resolution to elect the vice chairman of the Plaquemines Parish Council for the year 2017 and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. A resolution appointing an interim council member to fill the vacancy of the Plaquemines Parish Council for District 3 pertinent to Article 4, Section 4.06 of the Plaquemines Parish Charter for Local Self-Government until such time as a new Plaquemines Parish Council member for District 3 might be elected in a special election called for that purpose and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. A resolution calling a special election to fill the vacancy in the Parish Council of Plaquemines Parish, State of Louisiana, and other matters in connection therewith and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. An ordinance to amend the five-year capital improvements plan for the Jezero Bend Drainage Project and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. An ordinance to amend the five-year capital improvements plan for the Jezero Bend Drainage Project and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. That is all.
Thank you, Ms. Hurt. Ms. Salvant?
I have none.
Thank you.
I have three.
Three. Ms. Barber?
A resolution to appoint the members whose terms has expired on the Coastal Zone Advisory Committee and otherwise provide with respect thereto. An ordinance approving a plan of resubdivision for Teresa Tesevich et al., Plaquemines Parish, Louisiana, as shown on a map of resubdivision lot AT-2A into lots AT-2B and AT-2C, Glengarry Farms, Nearing Plantation Subdivision, is shown on the plans and plot of survey by Dufresne Surveying and Engineering, Inc., dated November 16, 2015. The owner having fulfilled all of the requirements of the subdivision and resubdivision ordinance of the Parish of Plaquemines without cost to Plaquemines Parish Government or the Parish of Plaquemines and otherwise to provide with respect thereto. An ordinance approving a plan of resubdivision of the property of part of heirs of Joseph Hingle property, Empire Plaquemines Parish, Louisiana, lots K4, K5, K6, and C2, heirs of Joseph Hingle property, Empire Plaquemines Parish, Louisiana, is shown on the plans and plot of survey by Dufresne Surveying and Engineering, Inc., dated January 13, 2016, revised August 30, 2016, the owner having fulfilled all of the requirements of the subdivision and resubdivision ordinance of the Parish of Plaquemines without cost to Plaquemines Parish Government or the Parish of Plaquemines and otherwise to provide with respect thereto.
Thank you, Ms. Williams?
I have one. An ordinance authorizing the Plaquemines Parish Recreation Department to allow non-parish residents to register and participate in all sports programs at a 200% increase over the parish residence fee in effect at the time of registration and otherwise to provide with respect thereto.
Thank you, Ms. Williams. We'll move to item 6A3.
An ordinance by the Plaquemines Parish Council as and on behalf of the Coastal Protection and Restoration Authority Board of Louisiana, the West Bank Levy District, Plaquemines Parish, and Plaquemines Parish Government to appropriate temporary work area easements in certain portions of lands in Plaquemines Parish, Louisiana, to extend the construction time for the West Bank and vicinity Mississippi River Levee, Mississippi River and Tributaries Project, Hurricane and Storm Damage Risk Reduction System, Resilient Features, English Turn Bend to Bell Chase, WBV-MOL 5.2, Baseline Stations 138 plus 00 to 254 plus 00, Plaquemines Parish, Louisiana, project for Mississippi River Levee, flood and hurricane protection purposes, and otherwise provide with respect thereto.
You offer, Mr. Black?
I offer.
Next for a second. Next for a second. Second by Mr. Burt. Mr. Black?
Yeah, this is basically just, what is this, WBV, which is from Main Street, I want to say right past F.A. Bear starts to English Turn on the West Bank.
Any questions?
It's a continuation of core project.
Sorry.
That's all.
Any question? Audience? Machines open? 683. And it's granted 9-0. Move to 6B.
An ordinance to approve the assignment between Marks Operating LLC as assignor of all assignors' right, title, and interest to Crew Energy LLC as assignee in and to that pipeline right-of-way agreement identified as PL-13-2 between Plaquemines Parish Government and the Grand Prairie Levee District as grantor to Marks Operating LLC as grantee, dated January 8, 2014, to authorize the parish president to execute a document of approval and otherwise provide with respect thereto.
Thank you, Mr. Bartholomew. You offering?
We'll offer for discussion.
Okay.
If the...
I'll second it.
All right. Mr. President, are we clear on this yet with LV? It's good to go? Mr. Chairman, I'd like to...
Remove my second?
Yes.
For discussion? And you're going to offer it for...
Yes, I'd like to offer at the permission request of the parish president.
Okay.
And worked out.
All right.
So offer.
Any questions? Machine is open. And it's granted 8 with one extension from District 2. Move to item 6D.
An ordinance to amend the 2016 main power structure and operating budget and otherwise provide with respect thereto.
I'll offer and ask for a second. Second by Mr. Edgecombe. I think we had discussion on this last time, and I think it's good to go. Any questions?
Yeah, one second, okay. Kurt. So these funds are going to be used to pay the sheriff's office bills, the invoices? So all you're doing is just taking, defunding that position, putting that money into that professional services line item? Okay,
we good? Russo?
So do we have funds left to fund the current person that we have on the payroll?
Yes, sir. The offered with changes is removing that position.
So we're going to one person
on
the payroll?
Yes, sir.
Well, that's going to get us... This is the deal, you know.
Yeah, what is the deal?
Well, because the whole thing was kind of shut down for some odd reason. I have no idea what meetings transpired. The agreement between PPG and the sheriff's office was that the sheriff's office was going to employ the current individual who's in that position, and the parish government would have nobody providing courthouse security. We would just pretty much pay a discounted detail rate to the sheriff's office to provide the responsible coverage we need for courthouse security. Well, prior to last meeting, unknown to myself and some others, and I even think our attorney, that deal was changed. And we had talked about, you know, appropriating $112,000 is budgeted for 2017.
It's 112.
So yeah, it's 112 for in a lot of professional services to pay the sheriff's office. But you know what this is going to do is going to allow us to pay the current employee for the remainder of the year, the one employee, and also to pay for the invoices that we currently owe the sheriff's office for courthouse security that they've been providing us. But we really need to go back to the table and decide what we're going to do.
The reason for that is because the individual in that position was not present at our meeting, and neither one of us knew the circumstances of the benefit.
You know what? But the problem is the 32 employees we laid off a couple months ago wasn't present at those meetings either. So, I mean, it's can't pick and choose who. I mean, that's an administrative decision.
And my decision was to request that the council keep the position funded to the end of the year.
Okay, we'll do that.
And then in the budget hearing, I'll request we go back to our original two-position employees for Plaquemines Parish Government.
Absolutely.
Okay, well, if that's the decision we made, that's fine. But I just want to clear up that that she'll be funded for the remainder of the year.
I think what happened is when it was going to be a situation with the person retirement, that's how we ran into the situation. So I think that changed everything. But I think what Mr. Ed is saying is perfectly, is exactly what the intent, at least my intent is, to fund the person throughout the remainder of the year. First of the year, we go back and retain two individuals.
Okay. Just, we need to have another, a separate meeting to discuss on how that works, because originally we were going to retain the two that we had funded in positions four. But the sheriff's office and that CEA, they had an issue with it. And that's when myself, Mr. Terrio, the sheriff, Mr. Landry, the sheriff's office attorneys, pretty much said that the sheriff's office would pick up that employee, and the sheriff's office, as a professional law enforcement organization, would provide courthouse security, where the administration wouldn't have to have to handle those duties. But yeah, I mean, that's a discussion we got to have later on, and that's how we're going to do. But for now, I mean, you're absolutely right. This pays the bills and funds the position for the end of the year.
Okay. Any other questions? Audience. Machines open. And the ordinance is granted 9-0. Move to 6E.
An ordinance to amend the 5-year capital improvements plan for various projects and otherwise to provide with respect thereto.
I'll offer and ask for a second.
And by. I'll second it.
Second. Ms. Angie, this is to clear up some of the leftover.
This is for bank service charges for the projects listed.
Okay.
I have a question on that. $160,000 for bank service charges?
It's bank service charges and paying agent fees. Yes,
I have questions. So I'm trying to understand this. So the East Bank levy account, we got to pay $8,000 to the bank?
No, sir. It's bank service charges that have accrued, and we're going to take the money out of.
Well, where are they accrued from?
From the account from the bank, sir.
I mean, from that project?
Yes,
from the East Bank levy project?
Yes.
We owe the bank $8,000?
No, sir. The money is in the project itself. This is going to be placed from the project into financial administration.
For what?
For the service charges, sir, the bank service charges.
For just the levy projects?
Just that project, yes, sir.
What project is that?
That's the East Bank levy project, sir.
Which one?
The first one.
No, what levy? What part of the project?
Well,
see, this is
good.
This.
This one just says East Bank Levy Project. It is HUR, the Hurricane Project, 0.1002.
Do we have a letter from the bank saying we owe them that amount of money for that?
No, sir, but we can provide it. If you prefer to defer, we can
defer
it.
I want to defer all. Well, let's discuss it if you don't mind, because I'm having a problem with $160,000 at the courthouse level.
I understand, sir. We can defer it, and Mr. Serpas will be here at the next council meeting.
Wanna
he
defer.
Said if it was a problem, we can defer this to the next meeting when he is here.
6E will be deferred.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
6F is withdrawn. 6G.
An ordinance to amend the 2016 Public Health Fund Operating Expenditure Budget, Mosquito Control and Health Departments, and otherwise provide with respect thereto.
I'll offer and ask for a second.
Second.
Second by Mr. Juneau.
Mr. Terrio, this will allow you to buy more chemicals for the plane?
Yeah, try to, and finish the year with chemicals, yes.
For the plane?
Plane and our trucks.
And the trucks?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
The plane uses a different chemicals than the truck, but this will provide our chemicals for the end of the year.
Okay. Before you got this, were we spraying at all, or we were out of chemical?
No, we were spraying, yeah. We sprayed twice last week, Crystal. I think we sprayed twice. I think you've seen the aircraft down there, yeah. And I, Crystal and I met with the mosquito department, and I don't think they provided it to her yet, but a schedule, asking the employees to come in later, spray later, and cover more territory. And we want, as soon as she gets it, we'll provide you with a schedule. So you all will know who's going to be in your district when.
Well, I appreciate that.
Okay.
I appreciate that because no one's in my district at any time that I can see.
As soon as Crystal gets it, she'll copy all the copies.
And I appreciate that, but let me explain to you. I saw Halloween. It was terrible, but they were spraying beforehand. I saw one truck spraying with two guys riding in it.
Yeah.
Okay, so I have a problem with that. I want either.
At that meeting that was discussed.
Okay. I witnessed that myself. And two of them could have been in trucks instead of
And we looked at all the other options. Some council members were looking to drive a truck, but it's the only people that can get on those trucks is parish and employees. The chemicals are mixed by licensed people at the facilities. All you need is a license to drive the truck, but they have to be parish employees. They can't be volunteers. But
I think I'm a parish employee.
This plan should help out.
I'm not a parish employee. I get the benefits.
Yeah, that's it.
Okay.
No, but some council members said they had so-and-so in the district that was going to come drive the truck.
I don't mind driving the truck again. I'll say it. But
I'd like to offer and also ask them to bring the truck.
Council members can drive.
No, tell them, bring it. I'm driving. Bring it. Bring it over here, right here at the parish county seat right here. And I'll pick it up from here.
There you go.
And I got my chemical license, too, so I can show you that one.
All right.
Got all that ready to roll. Before I did airplane, you can burn that, scrap that airplane.
If possible, we'll get you a truck.
Yeah. Sell that airplane, buy more trucks, and put people back on the road.
Any other questions? Machine's open on 6G. And it's granted 9-0. We will move to 6P.
A resolution stating Plaquemines Parish Council's endorsement of International Marine Terminals Partnership to participate in the benefits of the Louisiana Enterprise Zone Program.
I'm sorry, Mr. Salvant, you're going to offer?
Oh, yes, sir.
No offer?
Yes, I'll offer.
And I'll ask for a sec. Well, do we have to fill in the blank first? Huh? Today's date of November 10th, 2016. With that, you'll offer, and I'll second it, Mr. Salvant. Any?
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. Line 28 on today's date, which is the 10th of November.
Okay.
And with that, I offer.
Offered. It's been second. Offer is read, Miss. You good?
Yes, offer is read.
Offer? Mm-hmm. Huh? Yeah, November 10th.
10th in November.
Oh, 10th. Yeah, 10th day of November.
And I just would like to say and add before the vote is taken is that this company, but it is great on employing locals. So I have no problem with putting this legislation forward.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions? Machines open on 6P. Mm-hmm. And it's granted. You press no.
Oh, I'm sorry. My nail. Let's do a retake.
Blame on your nail.
All right.
Let me do it.
The machine is open.
I didn't get to do my nails this week. Apologize.
All right. That's machine. And it is 9-0. Granted. 6R, Mr. Black. Withdrawn.
I didn't do mine either.
R withdrawn?
Yep. Q was deferred, right?
Yeah?
Yeah, accuse it first.
Okay. We'll move to item 7A, introductions on resolutions with being sought.
A resolution to rescind, annul, and set aside resolution number 16-389 relative to the incorrect assignment and publicly noticed address for the residence owned by Cheryl Terrence in Braithwaite, Louisiana, and otherwise provide with respect thereto.
All right, there's been an offer under suspension. I'll offer the suspension. Mr. Bartholomew, second. The machine's open on the suspension. And the suspension is granted 9-0. Barbara?
A resolution to rescind, annul, and set aside resolution number 16-389 relative to the incorrect assignment and publicly noticed address for the residence owned by Cheryl Terrence in Braithwaite, Louisiana, and otherwise provide with respect thereto.
You offer, Mr. Bartholomew? I'll second. Any offers read? Good. Okay. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. Wait.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's the next. Okay.
All right. Okay. The machine is open. Well,
but before we, what are we voting on?
The one with the machine. This is the second one to correct it.
The first one. All right.
Small sheet. This is going to be the correction of the long sheet.
Okay. This is the rescind the.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Any questions?
It's on here.
Do you have it?
No.
I was going to ask. It's just rescinding the one they did last week because the address was wrong.
Right, I understand that.
Okay.
Mr. Russell.
And the resolution is granted 9-0. Move to 7A2.
A resolution setting forth that East Bank resident Cheryl Terrence justifiably relied on a public representation by the Plaquemines Parish government that the residential address for Cheryl Terrence was 5357 Hughes Street, Braithwaite, Louisiana, with respect to application for assistance to the Federal Emergency Management Association and otherwise provide with respect thereto.
There's been an offer under suspension. I'll offer. Second by Mr. Bartholomew. The machine's open on the suspension. And the suspension is granted 9-0. Barbara?
A resolution setting forth that East Bank resident Cheryl Terrence justifiably relied on a public representation by the Plaquemines Parish government that the residential address of Cheryl Terrence was 5357 Hughes Street, Braithwaite, Louisiana, with respect to application for assistance to the Federal Emergency Management Agency and otherwise provide with respect thereto.
You offer, Mr. Bartholomew? I'll second it.
Yes.
This is just a change of the address.
Yeah, change in the numbers. Everything else is the same. Put the wrong numbers in.
Okay.
And
question?
I'm going to ask the same question. This doesn't make us liable for her not getting the funds.
No.
Okay.
The attorneys did it. We got to remember them to do it to make sure that it was legal to do it. Let's see, all they done was the 911 address, they had the wrong numbers.
Right.
I'm trying to correct them. They had to say the same.
Now, I understand what happened, but we're putting ourselves out here to say that we made a grave error and that she is not responsible for returning the funds. I just want to make sure that we don't put ourselves responsible for making returning of the funds.
The question of the people that had financed it, according to the 911 record that they have, that's what it says. You corrected the 911 with that. You're not obligated to the funding.
We'll see.
All right, any other questions? Machine is open on the resolution. John, you voting? You vote? You got to vote.
It's almost gone.
All right, and it's granted 9-0. Move to item 7B.
Update and presentation by District 7, Councilmember Trufant Salvant.
Salvant.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, there recently was an updated information regarding the Myrtle Grove pump station, and we have our most, well, I'm gonna leave it there, Mr. Dugas. We're gonna have our engineer here that's gonna explain that update. So, Mr. Dugas, would you please?
Mr. Dugas?
Good evening, or good afternoon. We did have a meeting with the administration and Councilmember Salvant, and it seemed very well that everything was moving in order. The permit was applied for. There will be a revised plat submitted with it, and it will include the discharge going through the back levy. It wasn't very much more than that at this point.
Okay.
That's about it.
The only thing I have to add is Mr. Lawrence is not present, so if anybody happened to see him along the way, they can pass that on to him. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Dugas.
Okay. Anything? That's it? We'll move to item 7C.
Update by administration on water compliance projects and loan application. Councilmember Roussel.
The paperwork has been submitted. Mr. Bordelon has submitted the paperwork to the DC office. We're still waiting. We spoke to him yesterday, but so far everything looked well.
That's so do we have a schedule of when they may make a decision whether or not we're going
to
get
these? He's pushing to get it through this year. He said the quicker he get it done, the better it's going to make him look. So he want to do it before this year's out. That's his desire. But everything is going according to plan. I guess they just revised looking at it. But we spoke to him yesterday.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Move to 6-7-D.
District 1 update, Councilmember Bartholomew.
Paulo driven for the tower, back at the courthouse, communication tower that's just finished that. The test piles are finished with the courthouse. They are sending the results up to their engineers for the contractor to them to evaluate the condition because the piles, what the weight on it, it did sank a little bit. It went down a little bit. So they have to evaluate that, whether or not they have to add more pilings or will they have to go deeper, or is it sufficient? So those are things that they have to do the analysis on that. Also, we made the comment with the contractor, and he advises that he will get ready for the dedication ceremony deal with him. What he and the engineering company will sponsor that, so I'm assuming that we won't have to pay any money for that particular event, so the parish won't have any money to put up since we don't have any. But I am also, the mosquitoes are terrible, and it's not no fault of anybody else, it's just the way they are. And we'd appreciate the truck to let us spray some little more. Everything else is all right, so far.
You good?
So far.
All right.
Oh, I'm sorry, but when the Mardi Gras pass thing, we introduced that, and we met with St. Bernard last week. Mr. Lapine was there, and we're going to have another meeting with St. Bernard and the landowner to meet with our legal department and administration when we can set it up to come over and discuss the possibility of the mud closure or redoing the salinity control device at the Mardi Gras Pass to restore what was lost to oyster industry. It also came to pass that some people in Plattman Parish government encourage the breach. Kind of dug it so it took off. But I'm waiting on the documentations and the letters from the people that has that information. And the reason, my understanding, that they did because of the BP oil spill. But this is just conversation. This is not in hand or not concrete yet. But this is something that came out the last couple of days that was told when we met concerning the Mardi Gras Pass. So it was never a natural breach. That's all, Mr. Chairman, council members.
Thank you, Mr. Bartholomew. Move to 7E.
Discussion of LSU Ag property by Mr. McCarthy. Councilmember Trufant Salvant.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Mr. McCarthy will come with a brief presentation regarding LSU property.
Yes, I am Dr. Dick Lee from 3919 Fisher Ferry Road, Vicksburg, Mississippi. I am the CAO of Leprechaun Farms, and I want to thank you all for this opportunity to make this presentation. Essentially, we want to talk about the LSU ag property development. Next slide. You all know there's approximately 100 acres there. There's a recent sandbar pit on site. The existing appraisal value was made prior to the pit being dug, so a new appraisal is required. The office building has been damaged. The walls need to be fixed, and the roof needs to be fixed from Hurricane Katrina. And a large warehouse has been removed, and the slab is left out there. Next. What we're proposing or asking for is a 20-year lease at $5,000 a month. The initial lease will pay for the damages caused by Hurricane Katrina, about $200,000. This will essentially renovate the office building, and the warehouse will be rebuilt. Next. And the proposed use of the land is essentially to convert the property into greenhouses and hydroponic houses for nurturing plant species. And we're hoping to produce some biofuel plants to be used in one of our other projects for biofuels, produce plants to relieve arthritis pain. We'll be producing plants to reverse diabetes and high blood pressure, and we'll be producing some vegetables also. Now, the property will essentially serve as a market for tropical teas that we'll produce. It'll serve as a market for honey, for fruit juices, purees, and jellies. And we'll also have natural foods out at the on the property, and essentially have something of a farmer's market for local products to be on the site. So we're hoping to promote local Louisiana products, and we're going to be providing jobs for local residents. Next, please. We're essentially planning to convert the property into something productive, and we'll be renovating and establishing viable activities on the property that we're looking to provide jobs and promote local Louisiana products and restore pride back to the parish. Next slide. So what we're hoping for, we're requesting, is an approval to proceed with these development plans on the property. If you recall, the council did authorize the past parish president to work up a lease agreement. We would hope that we could go ahead and finalize a lease agreement and get that finished up. And again, we're requesting cooperation from the council and the administration. And it's important for you to know that the development of the property will have no cost to the parish. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, sir.
There's one thing that's going to probably be changed. I had a conversation the other day with President Theriau. We will probably pay a $1 a month lease until such time as we can use the office. We have set aside underneath the Biofuel International, we have set aside $1 million for the improvement of LSU Ag Center. We will pay for the improvement of the building. At that time, we will probably like to pay maybe a token $1 a month lease, and at such time, we'll probably invite the council down there to come look at the building that will be restored according to the way LSU had it originally. And then we'll move in there, and once we're able to move into the office, we will pay a $5,000 a month rent for the building. Any questions? Go ahead.
All right. Any questions from the table? Nope. Thank you, Mr. McCartney, for your presentation.
I would appreciate at least a 20-year lease because we've got to pay it back.
Okay.
Thank you.
Take that in consideration. Thank you. Move to 7F.
Actually, if we would defer it because I want to get people from the sheriff's office to come through.
Okay. All right. 7F is deferred.
The fireworks stand and all that.
7H.
Discussion regarding recreation budget cuts. Councilmember Burt.
Burt.
I'll keep this very brief. I just want to encourage my colleagues to please take a look at the budget books if you haven't done so. When we were handed the book a couple weeks ago, I did comb through it the first day I got it, and I was pretty shocked and alarmed to see the recreation budget cut the way it was. So without going into a lot of detail, I would just ask my colleagues to please take a look at that recreation line items, and we need to do everything we possibly can as a council to restore as much as possible to the recreation department. I mean, these are our kids, this is our future, and I take recreation to heart as a volunteer, as a parent, and so I would just ask my colleagues to please review that recreation budget as much as possible and help fund it back. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Burke. We'll move to item 8, approval of the minutes. I'll offer. The machine's open on the minutes. Okay, let's do the minutes. All right, do the minutes first. And the minutes approved 9-0. Mr. Freeman.
Thank you, Mr. Lapine. Upcoming, we have our football playoffs. They will begin at South Plaque Elementary Tuesday at 6:15, 7 and 8, and there will be two games there. We also have a game in Belchase at 6 p.m., followed up by a playoff for 7-8 Saturday, the 19th. The 9-10 will begin at 7:15 at South Plaque High School on the November 15th. And November 15th at Cypress Park, we have two games. That will be followed up by a championship game November the 19th. We also have an 11-12 game that's at Cypress Park November 16th at 6 p.m., followed up by a championship game November the 19th. I want to make an announcement that we have a free soccer and skills coaching clinic that will be Wednesday, November the 30th. We have Nick Rundell from Challenger Sports coming in from Irving, Texas. He's going to do a free camp for the coaches. It's ages 7, 5 to 7. At 5:30 to 6:30, and ages 8 to 12 at 6:30 to 7:30. It's for the coaches and the players. Also, I want to let you know that the $1,000 grant that was given to us by Oronite for the milkweed plants, we planted those plants to attract the monarch butterflies at the park, and we were planting those today. While the meeting was going on, I received a photo of the milkweed plant, and they had a monarch butterfly had already landed on it. So it's an awesome attraction, and we hope to get some more and put them at some other key locations. We also have received a $6,000 grant from ConocoPhillips for the activity at the ball fields up there that's pledged to some of the workers there. So we're excited about that. I want to let some of the council members know that have called for playground sawdust, that we have a dump truck lined up to bring some sawdust that's been donated to all the playgrounds. And we had a report of a snake at Port Sulphur. The snake was killed, and we did put some snake away. So as those things happen, we also killed a couple of snakes at Cypress Park.
Okay.
So with that said, everything's going well, and I thank you all for the time for the announcement.
Okay. Thank you.
Motion to
Oh, and motion to adjourn by Mr. Edgecombe, second. By Mr. Give me a minute. And on the adjournment, we are adjourned at 5:446. Thank you.